though.
Yeah.
Welcome to the You Are Here podcast. My name is Mike. This is episode 56 of the podcast. Find the podcast on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Anchor.fm, YouTube with the video, www.youareherepodcast.co. We cannot afford the M. Boom. My name is Mike. We're here. We're here with a big group. Glad to have you guys back.
Thanks for having us.
We got Jordan. We got Carl.
Hey.
The I'll meet you here.
There.
Oh, my God.
Crew. So you are here. You are here. I'll meet you there.
Yeah, yes. You mashed it up.
There you go. There you go.
I gotta open my beer.
So what's up?
How's what's up, baby?
Oh,
if you heard
noise, we got a couple brews in, Carl.
Yeah,
always comes stacked.
If you remember the last time we were here, I brought a whole cooler that was publicly displayed behind us.
Yes,
and that was a good time.
What are you drinking right now?
This is Tonewood. Shout out Tonewood.
Shout out Tonewood.
Oakland, New Jersey. They're south.
Oakland, damn. Right.
Yeah, down by
near a little racist
Cherry Hill.
Do you guys only drink, you try to only drink Jersey beers?
No.
No, we just, coincidentally, we drink a lot of like beer from local breweries.
Gotcha.
So,
yeah,
I mean, exactly. The kind of beer that we both like just so happens to be
brewed a lot
in this area.
Yeah, so. Gotcha.
Yeah.
It's the water.
Yeah. And then we have Brick City. It's a water. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Brick City from Little Ferry and Magnify from Fairfield. So
shout
it's all
out.
Local. It's all local today. Keeping it local.
We patronize their breweries quite a bit. So
yeah, I tend to, you know, kiss a little ass.
Yeah. Any
a little,
free beer?
A little.
Any discounts?
I should have worn my Brick hoodie today.
No. There's a debacle currently because I bought this at a liquor store and paid less than at the brewery.
Whoa.
I'm a little upset.
We actually need to reach out to someone about this because we
how
don't
are they
really
making
know.
Money off it?
Well, that's what I'm saying. I don't know how. They must buy in like bulk. Like they must have like some.
I bet they get a
sale discount or something.
Yeah.
But well, that ain't cool.
But yeah,
it'd be like.
Oh.
So we've got a soundboard. If you can't hear
a single sound they're playing because I don't have headphones because no one told me to brought some headphones.
All right. Well, I'll do it and then I'll just do what it was.
Yeah,
I
need you to reenact whatever it is.
Yeah. It did. Oh.
That's nice.
So guys, you're back for episode 56. You were here
man.
Episode 30 something, right? Was it last time? 40,
yeah, it was a while.
40 something.
And then I was here for episode 4.
You were the first
inaugural guest. Yeah.
The first guest we had.
Yeah.
We're on the tail end. Well, I'm not even in on this much, but you guys are on the tail end of editing the film.
Yeah. So it's funny. Last time we were here, we were like a couple weeks like short of shooting.
That's
so we were
right.
talking about, you know, what to expect and stuff. And now we're basically 97% done. Mm-hmm. Like it's really just Jordan is finishing up the color work on it. Mm. I'm finishing the score and a little bit of the audio mixing, but we're basically basically good to go.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
And we'll have a separate, little thing that we're going to record for anyone who donated to the Indiegogo.
Yes.
We will send you an email blast. We're going to do a little round table. If you guys ever seen Hollywood Reporter, they do their own little round tables with directors, producers, writers and stuff. And so we're going to do a little thing like that for our film and we'll get into the nitty gritty about like the actual production and other things like that. A little bit more technical, but that won't be for this.
Yeah.
We talk a little bit, but that's basically it. So we're going to do that soon. So we don't have a date yet, but stay tuned. Check your email. Yeah. Check your spam box. I don't know. I've never done an email blast before, so I have no idea what to expect from that.
Yeah.
Anything you'd like to add about
No. Nothing to add.
Okay, cool.
It's weird like watching because you're creating the film. You're telling the story now with this editing process. Like it's you shape the story now basically, right? Like am I right by saying that?
Yeah.
There's a ton of footage, there's a ton of audio.
To a certain extent. You know, if you're shooting a documentary, documentaries generally you can go into it with a plan, but because of the kind of unpredictability of that form of filmmaking, you build the movie in post.
Right.
With narrative, a lot of the time you can kind of guess, but you figure out what you're going to get in the end, like in pre-production.
Got you.
But there's all these variables, like there's things, these unknown things that you experience on set that when you come into post, you come in contact with. And it's really you like putting out little fires like, oh, these shots don't match exactly, or there's audio issues, or you missed a shot or something crazy like that.
Yeah.
Ideally, those kind of things don't happen. But, you know, on low budget stuff, when you're doing multiple jobs on set, sometimes you miss something. So you fix
it's just
it
in nature.
Fix it in post, which is like not a good thing. No. But This time around, I think it's been pretty good.
I'm happy to say that we didn't miss any shots, because I think everything that we've shot together is always a moment where I'm just like, oh, Dave, we forgot this one thing. Or like, yeah, we have to like find a way to reshoot or get that extra shot.
There was a couple close calls on set. A couple like really early morning shots that I wasn't sure we were going to get what we needed. But in post, we definitely did. And like, I'm happy with everything.
I'm excited
to talk about it at length later. But yeah, as of right now, the part of post that we're in, like, it's pretty much all done and it feels good. I mean, I'm doing all the color grading without any of the sound stuff. I saw a cut with the sound.
Yeah.
And it sounds really good too, but I'm seeing just the visuals, like pure visuals in it. It's dope. Yeah. It's really good. It's one of the best things like I feel like I've shot.
Awesome.
And like, you guys obviously did a great job, and like, I feel like everybody came together the way that we planned on coming together, and it's working out, and those are the best kind of projects to be involved with.
Yeah.
100%. 100%. Yeah,
man. Yeah. This is tough because I want to talk about it.
I know, right? Yeah. What I just said about that Indiegogo. Yeah, no, we're doing it now.
No. We can't do it now. Can we say one thing that you remember from set? Like, is that cool? Because we have a ton of things, I feel like.
Yeah.
And I don't think that'd be given it. And it doesn't have to be even about...
Specifically, like, what one thing, like...
Just a memory you have. Something you'd be willing to share.
Oh.
During us... I have one. I'll share... I'll give you an example.
Start off, yeah.
Like, you threw the camera on the car for the one shot. Mm-hmm. And, like, as I'm backing out of the driveway, you're like, just... drive under 10 miles an hour and make sure these section cups don't move at all. But you're fine. And I'm like, okay.
Well, we secured the rig to like a couple points on the car. Yeah. So I think if the suction cups would have popped off, like it would have been okay. It would have sucked probably, it's not the end of the world. We didn't have the big camera on the car. We had the smaller camera.
Yeah.
So like,
that would have terrified me.
I didn't mean to scare you.
No.
But, it's not good, dude. But I mean, those shots are actually like some of the better shots I think we got. Especially there's a couple shots of Carlotta where it was like a single of her through the windshield.
And it's one of my favorites.
It looks amazing, honestly. I'm like, I can't believe it came out of this like 6-year-old camera. That we just threw in a suction cup on the windshield.
I was about to like not even get that shot. Right. I was like, man, we got to be in the living room by like 10:45.
Yeah.
And Jordan's like, can you sacrifice like 20 minutes? I'm like, it's a nice shot. Like, it definitely was one that I've written into that I really wanted to get. It was such a debacle that whole morning.
Yeah.
that's something too in post. I'm like looking at the shots that I got in the car with the red and like, we rode around the car and got like these nicer shots. And honestly, like, I like
those shots
from through the windshield on this old shitty camera more. They just have more character to them, and they're less shaky too. Which is But like, I mean, those are the kind of things you see. You don't see those things on the day of because you're too busy worrying about 50 other things.
Right, mm-hmm. Right.
So like, in post, we have time to sit and examine every frame and like really like nag ourselves about things we missed or whatever. And, you know, it's all right though, because with each one of these things, you learn something new about filmmaking. And for me, it's like kind of picking your shots ahead of time is like a way, way more important thing that I put value on. Like,
yeah.
I think I just assume I'm gonna wing it most of the time, and I usually can. Like, I think we have a shared knowledge, like a shared language of what we want and what we expect.
Correct. Yeah.
So like, I get on set and I know like this is what Carl wants, this is what I want, and I have the ability to just do it inherently. Like, there's a natural like language there, but you know, it is good to prepare. It's always good to prepare. Yeah. So
for sure.
I guess the one memory or story is the first night when we got to the house. Number one, me and Mike were the first one. Like, this will be a two-parter. We were the first ones up at the house, and it was like dark, and like there's no street lights on this thing. We shot in like Goshen, New York.
First and last, right?
Yeah. Wow. We were, dude.
Yeah, you were.
Yeah, you bailed on us.
Sorry.
But we got there, and like I didn't know which house was what. Like, you couldn't tell.
It was sketchy back there.
It was sketchy, and I actually pulled into the wrong house down the road.
Right.
I saw some lights on. I'm like, oh, the guy must have left the lights on for us. Whatever, like, you know, we told him we'd be coming in the evening, so it's like it's not completely out of the way.
It was just someone else's house.
Yeah, no, I got out of my car and I started walking towards the front door.
You saw someone walk through?
No, I saw someone walking like past in the window.
Oh, shit.
I think it was like the kitchen. They had like dishes in their hand. I'm like, well, that's not us.
I'm like, well, I should have just walked into their house.
Yeah, I wanted to. It was a nice house. Like, oh, this is the house. Nice. I'm like visualizing, like, okay, so the setup here tomorrow, we'll stage everything.
Meanwhile, they're looking at you outside their window, like just standing there.
Just like weirdo. It's like freaking cold out. It's like, why is he just standing there?
The
like,
dishes in their hands are just knives.
Yeah. Dude, it was dishes. Weird, man. It was weird. And I had I had very little service. So like I was gonna call you and be like, you know, but the phone call wouldn't go through.
Yep.
Yeah. And I'm just like, oh. Oh man. Then I saw a pair of headlights come down, and then like I saw Mikey. I'm like, yo, Mike, I don't know where this house is, dude. You gotta help me.
And we start walking around, there's like rubble from like, I don't know,
yeah,
like a farm and everything. Like, I don't know if we're in the right place.
Stuff, and then there's like a barn, and I'm like, that's not our barn, dude.
That barn. I don't want to talk about it now. I don't want to talk about it now. There was the fuck. I keep cutting myself off because I have so many. I want to talk about so much shit.
Yeah,
we're gonna save it.
Yeah.
But another thing I could say, it was the day before we shot, I had to get the keys to you guys, and I wanted to take photos of the interior of where we shot the meeting scene, and I got the keys. And my stepmother got, shout out Lisa Marie. I love
Lisa
you.
Marie.
She got the code for the lodge we shot at. She gave it to me. She texted me. She's like, okay, here's the code. Go there all confident. I'm like, I can't wait to open this bad boy up. I'm excited for tomorrow. Open it up. Alarm starts going off. No problem. I have the code. Beep, 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 beep. Keeps beeping. I'm like, oh no. Beep, 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 beep. I put it in wrong. Nope. Keeps beeping. I'm like, fuck. Did I hit the wrong end button? I do it 20 times and none of it's working. I start calling her, texting her. I'm like, oh no. And now I know the cops are coming because the alarm changes to like a fucking siren.
Oh,
I'm
God.
Like, I'm dead. I'm gonna get arrested.
Drake, dead. You live off the street, bro. What are you talking about? You've lived in Western Milford. Your
but
that's, life,
this is where my mind goes. I'm like, I'm getting arrested. I'm getting arrested for breaking and entering. And I think I was on the phone with you.
Yeah, you FaceTimed me.
I didn't know about this part.
I was showing him the place.
Oh,
I got the code finally and turned it off.
Yeah.
And I'm like, as I'm showing it, I'm like, the cops are here, Jordan. I think I'm going to go to jail. And they fucking come in. They come in and they're like, so what's going on here? Two of them. I'm like, I'm sorry, guys. Here to shoot a film. They don't know what the fuck I'm doing there. Like, there's never been a film shot in that place.
Likely story.
Yeah.
What's the movie?
Yeah.
Who's in it?
Anything I've seen.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, dude.
What are you working on exactly?
So
what have I seen you in? I'm like, nothing. Not a thing, sir. Yeah. I love that question. What have I seen you in?
Yeah.
Nothing. Oh, how about that?
Clearly nothing. I wouldn't be talking
to you. Yeah.
Yeah, I wouldn't be here.
Somebody else would be doing this.
Yeah. There's a million other things I'd be doing if I made something you've seen, okay?
Yeah, dude. But they were cool. After they're like, you guys, you do birthday parties up in this? What do you think? Birthdays here?
Oh, yeah. I'm the CEO
wedding
of the lodge. Yeah. We do.
I'm like, I'm bullshitting with them. And, I'm just like, yeah, you can fit probably 75 in here. 100.
You don't even know.
I don't know, dude.
Yeah, building code. You know, 75. It was max.
I was trying to tell him what he wanted to hear, but then they left.
Well, good.
And that's my story.
Yeah.
Story time.
Yeah. That was a fun one.
Yeah.
That
was a fun one, dude. How do I?
Oh, he's fucking it up. He's fucking it up.
I hit the wrong button.
All I hear is like a...
It's a crying baby.
Okay.
It's long.
Jesus.
It's really long.
It's still crying.
Just like real baby.
I don't want to hear that. It's terrifying.
Is that what the alarm
sounded like? Delete that one. I remember the next morning, I went... It was like 7 in the morning, and you went to go get the cast. And you were like, oh, by the way, make sure you put the code in right, or else the cops are going to come. I'm like...
And which one's the key you asked to?
Yeah, dude, you gave me like a ring full of like 30 keys.
It's like a janitor from like a 90s Nickelodeon. Yeah.
I got all my keys.
Literally, like it's like a circus ring of just keys. I'm like, and you're like, oh, I think it's like the bronze one with the little etching in it. I'm like, they all have etchings in it, bro. It's a key, man. What are you doing? And he's
so
like,
funny.
And then I found the key, and then you're like, all right, before you open the door. The code pad's on the right. You gotta run to it. Like, you gotta, like, once the door opens, you gotta run inside and just enter that code.
I didn't say that, did I?
Yeah, you did, bro. Yeah, you did.
If you're doing a big boulder, it's gonna come down from the ceiling and crush you.
Like, the day will be ruined if, like, you get this part wrong. And I'm like, oh my God, dude.
I wish I could see Carl jumping
dude,
around.
Dude, me too. Officer, please.
Oh, no.
Yeah, it was nuts. I got it first try, though. Thank you for giving me the right code.
I got you.
I was like, I don't have a lot of faith in you.
But
dude.
Imagine, see, it could have been the other way. It could have not showed up the day before. Cops came the day of, and we would have had a problem.
Out in bed, yeah.
But we're good.
They would have totally shot you, dude.
100%. Not trying to point anything out, but, you know, there is cameras here. You can see everyone, you know, just to...
You look kind of suspect. I'm getting...
You walk.
We're getting canceled. That's your teaser right there, boys.
Speaking of teaser, expect one in the next couple weeks.
Oh yeah, Dave's been hammering me for a teaser. He's like, so when are we getting some deadlines?
That would be.
That is true. That you are not wrong, and maybe I did take a little more time than I had originally planned. Right. But doing, it's fine. You guys it's good. Work? Yeah.
Everyone's working.
Yeah.
We have to submit some festival. There's so much shit to do.
Yeah, you take care. You take care.
And it's going to be fun. Yeah. And I'm really excited.
Yeah.
What's your next step?
Oh.
Yeah, what are you doing these days, Dave? Now that, you know, we've been working on this movie for the last couple months. What have you been doing?
Crazy revelations in my life, dude, this past couple of weeks, actually.
Really?
Wild.
Yeah?
Yeah, truly.
You better deliver, bro.
Yeah.
That's quite a lead in.
I experienced like... I don't know how to say this and be like anonymous at the same time. I found that there's things that I've carried in my life with me since I've been a baby through survival tactics on how I like live my life to not like fuck things up. And like, I've just learned like this really one specific thing that I do that's not good and healthy for me. And so now I'm like actively like aware of it. And doing things to become a better person by not doing that thing anymore.
Wow, man.
Which is, it's weird to say it like that, but like.
So you're not going to tell us what it is.
No,
it's fine.
It's fucking, whatever.
So you're growing up is what you're saying.
I'm growing up. Yeah. I'm 29 cool. And I'm figuring out like who the fuck I am. And like a really cool, specific man. Thing is like.
Hey, at least you can pinpoint that. Like that's
hard to pick that out. That's like, and that's something that you don't notice.
No.
Until you ever like, you put like that in the spotlight.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? And that's the hardest thing to do.
And somebody else had to bring it to me.
That's what I was going to ask you. Like someone else.
That's something
to,
you
like,
don't notice.
Because you don't see it.
Someone who's like a qualified person had to like bring that to my door and be like, hey, what do you think about this? And I was just like, goosh. Just fucking a ball of tears and snot. And I was
oh my
like,
God, dude, Jesus.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
But it's I don't know. Because like, I think like, I don't know. I say all the time, like, oh, I journal and I try to find out who I am and my art and shit.
Yeah, yeah.
And this one thing is just like,
it's a glaring.
Just fucking, yeah. I've never caught it. Like, it just, I didn't even know it existed. It's like a fly in the room. I didn't know it existed.
Yeah. Wow, man.
I'm just glad I know what it is. I don't know. Well, so it's been a week of growth.
Well, it's good that you figured it out because some people never do.
Yeah.
And they live their whole lives like in denial, or they don't live their truth.
Yeah.
And they end up just being fucking assholes their whole lives.
I went back
to themselves and to other people.
100%. I went back and watched Honey Boy. Again,
I just watched that last
week. Did you really?
Yeah.
What'd you think?
It's fucking good.
I fucking loved it.
It was good. I don't understand why it didn't get nominated.
I know.
Stuff at the Oscars.
That, my dog.
I know.
You're my fucking dog.
I don't get it.
I don't get it either. But
I haven't seen it, so I can't comment too much.
It's not a simple story, but it's a very contained, very focused story on some moments in this young kid's life. Shia LaBeouf, I guess, is like, you know, it's I don't know how exact the story was.
Right.
I know a lot of it is based on his life, but like, it's very focused in on certain things about his life, certain really messed up scenarios that happened to him. So like, yeah, it's not as big of a movie as 1917 or like even Parasite like anything like that, but it was really good, man.
I thought it was written really well. I thought he did a great job with it.
The dialogue
and performance.
Yeah, the performance was unbelievable.
Yeah.
But the I think the premise or the thing that we're trying to, if you boil down that specific story, I think what the takeaway is, you get a cycle of pain if no one chooses to like forgive or to let go of a grudge. You know what I mean? Like it can continue
generational
abuse pain.
Yeah. But that's one of the biggest things in that film is like that hurt people essentially.
That's
like,
right.
There's you know a point like. Shia LaBeouf's the character he plays, essentially playing his own father, who's been through some shit, has PTSD, takes it out on his kid. The kid has PTSD, grows up, takes it out on people around him, takes it out on himself. So it's like, that it's so true when you really think about like most of the time people who have problems that they work through as an adult is because of stuff that happened to them as a kid. 100%. And their parents had issues that because of stuff that happened to them when they were a kid. I mean, I could say the same thing.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
Everyone
yeah.
has something.
Most people. I feel like it's important. I don't know what I'm talking about, but I feel like for me, it's important to like clock it, go back, see, really find out what those things are and how they've followed you throughout your life and your actions and your behavior.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then like work on specific like ways of changing that, ways yeah. of attacking like a new way of living that even though it feels comfortable to be this way because you've done it your whole fucking life, it's going to end to like ruination by the end of it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, yeah.
In the story, he talks about at one point, his father is talking to his son, I think it's towards the end of the film, and he says something like, how's it go? It goes, it's important to know when you grow up, it's important to know where you come from, he says. And he says, we come from like a generation, or like a bunch of good people, good-hearted people, right? All of them good. He goes, but somebody hurt them, and so they were in a lot of pain, and so they drank. And he goes, that's what you come from. And then he says, each one of them has a grudge. We've all got a grudge. And he goes, I know you got one too. He goes, but if you don't set the grudge down, it'll kill you. It'll kill you.
Yeah.
And then, you know, that just makes sense. You go to drugs, you go to abusing other people without knowing it. You go to abusing yourself without knowing it to cope with this grudge you don't even know exists in you.
Yeah. It'll end up just taking you down.
Yeah. I've had friends tell me like at a therapy session, they're afraid to talk about that their mother, they're upset at their mother or their father for a certain thing because they feel bad about even saying the words like,
because you don't want it to be like a real thing, yeah.
So. I mean, maybe it's just it's like taboo to, or to them, it feels wrong to express you've hurt me, and it's okay. Like I forgive you, but first I need to. The first step is I got to say this is where I was. I feel I was wronged by you and hurt,
mm-hmm.
and you know I get it.
Yeah,
I never got to have that conversation. So like, when my mom died when I was 26, and I had. I was like a really angry person in my 20s. I'm still in my 20s, but my early 20s, I was like just very anxious and angry. And I had like a rage about me that like, if you were my friend, you didn't really notice it probably, but like people I was had close relationships with, my partners or like my mom specifically, because I lived with her and like, she was a single mom. So like she raised me and my brother and we had that kind of close-knit relationship, but we were always fighting. We were like always fighting. And she had a lot of the same problems that I had. She had a really, really rough childhood though. So I kind of like understand it.
Yeah.
I had a pretty good childhood. I mean, we were pretty like down and out, like as a kid, like she was a single mom. She had a decent job, but we were pretty poor-ish, like on the lower end of the spectrum in terms of money. And I know she did what she could for us, but it wasn't really like what she wanted to do. And I could tell that she knew she was giving us a better life than she had, but it wasn't the life that she necessarily wanted to give us. She wanted to do more. She always wanted to do more and more and more. And I think I always took that as like her son, I always wanted to prove that she didn't have to do more and that I would do it. And we just like fucking fought constantly. Yeah. Up until the day she died, we were fighting. But it was because we loved each other and we didn't know how to like let each other know that without... I guess it was like almost like a competition. Like,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
And then when she died, like it was like almost like a pressure valve got like open in me. And I like, I don't know, man, that rage like evaporated because like I was so sad. I couldn't feel mad anymore.
Yeah.
I was mad at myself. But like by the time the depression went away and like the fog of like dealing with funeral shit and like all that wore off, like I was just sad. And like the rage was gone because I was like, I don't have to worry about her anymore in a way. But now what? Now that space that the rage occupied is empty. What do you do in there? So you have to fill it with other things, and either you fill it with more rage and depression, or you grow from it and you do something different. And that's the direction that I tried to go in.
Wow.
So I feel better now than I ever have, even though I'm still sad. Like I feel good about my life, and in a way that sadness and her dying like freed up space in my head and my heart.
Wow.
So I mean, it's like, it's tricky, but like there is something to be said about accepting who you used to be and like how miserable you used to be. I see it now. There's a clarity after everything that you see, like you see how fucked up you were.
Yeah.
and admitting you're fucked up is the first step in becoming less fucked up.
Totally. Mm-hmm.
So yeah.
Being able to take hold of that is like crazy.
I'm not saying I totally did though, because there's like a constant battle. Like, you know, I still feel it sometimes. You wake up some days and you're like, what am I doing? Yeah. You're like, what the fuck am I doing? But if you can at least like confront it, it's something to build off of. And when she was around and I was like worried about her constantly and worried about myself, like that duality of being selfish but also selfless. You know, it created nothing but stress. So,
right.
I mean, now, you know, I try and take accountability for how I'm feeling. I notice myself fighting people a lot less. So, I mean, you know, those are important things to like learn. I feel like that's the point I finally like became an adult. Some people don't have to do that. They do it in other ways or they don't do it at all. I don't know. I'm not saying I'm better than anybody else emotionally or anything, because I still have problems, but it was my way of at least admitting that there was something wrong, like with me, and not really blaming other people for it. I was like, oh, that's what was going on. And like,
right.
I see it now. So
you took ownership of what was going on, what you're putting out there, what you were.
Yeah. I realized like I was an asshole essentially.
Gotcha.
You know, when you like can step back and be like, this is why, you know, like,
it
wasn't necessarily all my fault, but I was like, oh, I kind of get why I was in such a bad place and why I was so fucking depressed and why I was so anxious and my anxiety was making me into a like a kind of a bad guy to be around. And why it made stuff like my relationships fail, and it made my professional life not reach its full potential, and like all those things like were a byproduct of me just being like fucking mad all the time. Like, just I was a mad person. And there's no amount of self-medication that really fixes that. It's self like realization that fixes it. Is like
the growth,
realizing what the fuck is wrong with you. And I wasn't lucky enough to go to therapy. I actually see it as a really good thing to do. I never had like I never had that ability. So I'm lucky that I was able to figure some stuff out myself. I'm still figuring it out. Maybe at some point I'll have good enough insurance to make it to a therapy session. That'd be really cool. But just being in the position where I can like admit I'm wrong for the first time was a big deal. And I watched movies like Honey Boy, and that's essentially what the characters in that movie are doing. They're struggling with that. And I'm like, oh shit. Like, I really related to that movie. Like,
dude,
more than just a movie. Like, it was like, oh, like this is real life. Like, shit. Like, it's not shrouded in ego. It's like, it's just people being angry and sad.
Yeah.
And there's nothing wrong with it. And it's a story about that. And it's not trying to be anything else.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I really related to you talking about having what your mother said about like wanting to do better and have a better life for you guys and to do always make it bigger and better. And like, I feel like that, I told you this before. Yeah. I have this letter my mom wrote me when I was like fucking 9. I wrote to him. Where she's talking exactly about that. And she said that my whole life. She always wanted to, like, she still says that, like, you know, I wish I could have, you know, she just wanted me to have like this awesome life and me and her to go off and fucking, you know, have this big, beautiful life. And so she worked really hard and she did her best, but she, you know, she's still doing her best. And I love her very much. I'm very proud of her. But there's something left in me from being so young and seeing that and her and saying and what you just said, which is like, I want to like do better for us too. So that's, you know, that's something that's it's on me somewhere, and I know that's kept me moving forward in my life, and it's part of my work ethic, and it's why I burn myself out, and it's why I feel like I push too hard sometimes, and but it my point is like it goes back somewhere. It comes from something.
Yeah.
And it's cool to see where that comes from. It's cool to just at least know it. It's justified. You're not a bad person for it. You know, it makes total sense. And now you have a future to look forward to where you can take care of yourself better now that you know that. You can move forward.
I would say, like, I haven't really written much about this specific thing. I've written about her death and stuff, but I say to myself, at least, like, the last lesson she taught me was, like, how to care about myself a little bit. Because her dying was almost like a release. Like, I didn't have to really worry, because she had a lot of health problems. So I was like, leading up to her death. So I was like constantly thinking about that. And, you know, a byproduct of that misery that came out of her dying was that release, that
sense of peace.
That, yeah, man. Unfortunately, like, that's what it had to come to, I guess. But I obviously would have put up with an infinite amount of that like struggle,
yeah,
if I had to, if, yeah, it meant that she was still around.
Absolutely.
But because she's not, my life took a total turn.
Right.
You know? And, you know, right, I think people aren't so lucky to have those kind of like violent epiphanies. You know, it takes them a long time. It takes them a lot of therapy, and it's expensive and hard to do that emotional work. It doesn't just hit them like a bus, you know? So when it does, you have to kind of just take it for what it is and keep going. Cause,
yeah,
like I said, you either learn something from it or it fucking destroys you.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then what do? You just become that hurt person that continues to hurt other people even worse than before.
That's right. That's
so
right.
That's not a good solution either, I think. So
yeah.
Wow.
It's scary when you can't see it. It's scary when,
yeah,
like,
you're a lot doing of people can't. A lot of people, yeah, are too into their own problems to even acknowledge it, or they're in denial, or they're too hurt to really look at it. I don't know.
Yeah.
I think I count myself lucky for going through what I went through, only because it freed up that space.
For sure.
Because I could still be that person that I was in college or in high school even. Because people don't grow out of that sometimes. And yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, the one Shia LaBeouf movie I did see was Peanut Butter Falcon.
Oh, okay. another heavy movie, but fan
beautiful.
Beautiful. Loved it. We watched it together.
Yeah, I remember you told me.
Yeah, it was... It's like, oh, we have it. Want to watch? I'm like, yeah. Dave was talking about it. A lot of your friends were like posting about it on Instagram. Yeah, I'm like,
I love that movie.
I'm like, what's the deal here? I got to check this out. You know?
What'd you think?
Loved it, dude. Loved it.
It's beautiful.
We talked about, like, that. That's like a movie so we'd love good. To make. Like, that would be great.
That is,
like,
the movie, yeah, I want to make.
Oh, yeah.
That type of, you know.
I don't really aspire. Like, if you're gonna tell human stories, like, that is such a good human story to tell. Like,
why do you think it works so well?
I don't know, man. The magical realism of it.
Yeah.
The fact that you're seeing it from Zach's, like, what's his name in the movie though? Is it Zach?
I think it's Zach.
It's Zach too, right?
Okay, yeah. You're seeing it from Zach, the character, main character of the movie. He's got Down syndrome, and you're seeing it through his point of view.
So it does have that magical realism.
Yeah, there's a childlike innocence to it, but, you know, he's an adult in the movie, but he's got, like, kind of a childlike enthusiasm to life, and the story revolves around him escaping from an old person's home that he's being put in. And chasing after this dream, it reminded me of, like, a lot of, like, road movies. It reminded me of,
like, the buddy road and trip
of
movies,
like, A Beast of the Southern Wild, like that movie. It, also, the setting lended to, like, this
beautiful,
like,
visuals. Beautifully shot.
Where is it? South Carolina,
somewhere around there, right? They started.
It was in the Carolinas. But it's just a beautiful. I don't know. It's just beautiful. The dialogue was really good.
Dialogue was great, realistic. The chemistry between him and
I think that play with Jaya was fucking
that night scene where he talks about
fuck,
where he becomes Peanut Butter Falcon
when he's talking about
before that
being the bad guy.
Yeah, and the good guy. And he's like,
he says he wants to be a bad guy. Right?
Yeah.
But he said, because I can only be the bad guy because I have Down syndrome.
Yeah, dude. I was like,
Shia told me no.
It's like, don't say that about yourself. Like, don't ever let someone tell
you're
you
you're a good
that.
Guy.
Yeah. Like, don't ever let anyone tell you that you can't do that. You know, like, and I'm like, damn. That's something you hear a lot in, like, basically every movie. Like, you know, don't let anyone tell you. But, like, I don't know. When I saw that one, I was like, different. Oh man,
I hit different. I think. To be honest, it reminded me of, and we're nowhere near close to, you know, whatever. When they did a beautiful thing, I'm not comparing us to them, but, like, the takeaways from what I watched that film is I researched these guys a lot, these two coworkers a lot, the Ryan Nielsen dude and the other guy that made this film together, and then bringing on Shia and Zach, and they knew Zach for years, and they said, we're going to make a movie before you, because he wanted to be in a movie.
He wanted to be an actor.
And so they built this movie around Zach, and, that's love. That movie is like covered in love, like regardless.
You can feel it.
Totally. And Shia and him had a really deep connection, a true connection.
Showed on screen for sure.
Yeah, man. Everyone did share like a human to human respect for each other, and like in the midst of that, let's tell a story together.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think when you watch the film, you fucking feel it and see it in every frame.
Yeah.
It's the first movie in a while that I watched and I was immediately like, I kind of want to watch it again.
Yeah, right now.
Like,
yeah.
I just want to watch it again.
Yeah. Like, put that repeat on. Yeah, dude.
But yeah. It reminded me of us. Yeah. Like when we do things, it reminded me
sure,
of
sure, yeah. I can see that for 100%, sure.
Yeah.
You know, we may miss the mark in a lot of places.
It felt accessible too. Like it felt, as an indie filmmaker, as someone aspiring to be someone making features like that.
Yes.
It didn't feel like it was a movie I couldn't make.
Totally.
It felt like it was somewhere ahead of me. But like, we talked about it a lot after, and we're like, dude, like that feels like the movie, like we said, we want to make it, but like that we could make it, not that we just want to make it. Yeah. I want to make a lot of.
Of course, there's a lot of things.
I would love to make the next Star Wars movie, but I don't think I could actually do that. Yeah, I'm like realistic, you know. Yeah. But like Peanut Butter Falcon feels like something a bunch of friends made, and like they had a lot of help making it, but it feels like something people who gave a fuck about the project made. It wasn't just like a money grab, you know? Right. So that's uncommon lately. Even in indie films.
I remember I had that same feeling, and I remember I was like, what's the budget for this?
Yes, you kept saying that.
And like I looked it up. Right? Yeah, it's like 20,000.
Yeah, because
and of course, there's definitely
help. There's a lot of donated time and stuff.
Yeah. But you can tell it's that low because of all the love.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They're all
people wanted to work on it. It wasn't just the paycheck.
Yeah, when they pitch it to people too, it was that the idea of it spawned from a true connection with these people.
Yeah.
Wanting to tell this story with Zach and like, I don't know, man. It's just really inspiring. That film specifically really, really inspired me to like, you know, in this stage of the game where we're at, if we're being real, like we've done a lot of short films.
Features next.
Yeah, if it has to
that's
be
what it feels like,
next,
right? It feels like on the verge of a feature.
Dude, I've done six of these things. I'm ready. I'm ready.
You essentially made a feature. Like, if you just stitch all them together.
Yeah, dude, let's stitch all the way up to this. Dude, you have like an hour and a half over, I probably.
How do you feel about that? How do you feel about where we're at right now? And like being in this stage of your career, your like long career. God will.
You guys have been working together for a while too.
I went back and watched all the shit because I'm working on my reel for
I gave you some 2012 was broken, I think. Wow. Yeah. But I only shot like a part of it, like, and then Katie directed it. So it wasn't even like it wasn't like our thing. Like,
no, right. It was like
our first thing was some review.
It was the first time I hit you up and said, let's do
this. Yeah, for sure.
I think we talked about this.
Yeah, we talked about this last time. Yeah. So
but I remember I saw some review at one of the film festivals at school, and I was like, what the fuck?
I saw
these guys?
Indian Summer, was it? What was the film you did?
Which one?
Not Indian Summer. It was the one you did at the festival. It was
Sahara?
The first one I saw. Sahara. Sahara.
Was that the same festival, though?
I think
yours was the year before.
I saw yours the year after.
Yeah. It did pretty good that year. But, yeah. I mean, the bar was pretty low, though, too. That, like, the student film festivals are kind of...
Yeah, I mean, I was going to say, like, he's, like, saw it at art.
But when you're... Well, it's all relative. When you're at that stage...
Sure. But you know a good thing.
That's right.
I saw your movie, and I was like, oh, fuck. Like, these guys are fucking serious. But it was like... You know, again, it didn't feel like something I couldn't do. I was like, I see. There's some fucking good people here.
Yeah, we're just...
It made me quickly realize.
And I gave you like a, hey man, just want to let you were with your mother.
Probably, yeah.
I remember that.
Yeah, when my like thesis film was in the festival, I brought my mom. And...
I remember that.
Yeah.
I remember that specifically. I think that's the first time I talked to you.
I worked on like three movies that year. Like I was really busy. Like I have so much less energy now. It's kind of crazy.
It's crazy. I can't even edit this movie that we're doing.
Yeah, it takes us a long time, but the quality has gone up exponentially.
Oh, dude. Oh my God.
I don't know, man. You trade some of the quantity for quality.
100%. But how do you feel now being where you're at right now in this phase? You're
like right now, like
on the tail end of editing
2020. Just finishing up.
How you feel? 2020. How you feel?
How do you feel, dude? Like for real. And this stage since 2012.
Well,
like,
I'll say, let me divert this to two separate answers. To answer your question, I feel great. That I feel like we definitely are on like the precipice of like, you know, this kind of leads into I had coffee with him like a month ago. It was like a couple weeks ago. And you were like, what's your goal for 2020? What's like one thing you want to do now that the movie's wrapping up? And like without hesitation, I'm like, I want to write a feature, man. Like I want to write. I don't even care if we make it this year. I just want 90 to 120 pages with my name on the front.
Wow.
Man, stacked together.
The first step to like, making a feature is to write one.
I know. And so I'm like, dude, like I got like, and I, you know, and it goes back to what we said where, six short films in, it's like, I think we're ready. Yeah, I think
hell yeah.
How we handle it on set, you know, and like how we handled from pre to production to post, like, I feel like, dude, like, we
really move a certain way that, like, I don't feel on any set I get cast in. Like, I don't feel that kind of comfortable flowing movement. Even when there's a problem, everyone's just like, yep, let's, this is how we fix it, and then next thing.
Yeah, yeah.
The preparation was great on this. I felt so tip top on this last one.
Yeah,
the way we moved together, I mean, the way you guys,
it was kind of scary because there's a lot of, like, we ended up getting a lot more downtime than I had planned.
Yeah,
so I'm like, did we fuck up?
Yeah,
like, are we missing something?
I kind of felt that too.
I'm like, let's get, like, Foley. Like, Mike, let's go get some Foley sounds, dude. Like, yeah. I need to do something.
I'm outside in, like, the field, like,
yeah, which worked great, by the way. But we had a lot of downtime.
No,
and
we
stuff.
Just,
I'm like,
we just knew what we needed.
We just, yeah, like that. The first day, Saturday afternoon,
yeah,
dreading it. Just like the amount of coverage that we had originally planned. Mm. Like, I didn't know if it was gonna cut. Like, were we jumping the line? Were we doing all this shit, dude? Like, that scene when I was actually cutting it took me like an hour just to get the basic cut. I'm like, oh, it cuts together fine. Like, the continuity is fine. Like, it was fine. Like, it was, yeah. I'm like, why was I so worried about this? Like, obviously, you should be worried. It was a lot of script time, you know, but like, again, me and Jordan were just like talking, like, okay, how do you want to do this? How do you want to do this? What goes next? What's the next shot? I'm like, well, I got to get a close up of this thing here, and I got to get a close up of this face here. And knowing that I needed that stuff, but letting him shoot it however he wanted.
Yeah.
It was good for me because then I could just, like, it's like there's a timeline in my head. I could just see myself cutting it as we're doing the takes.
Yeah. You're editing. Yeah.
I'm editing in my head.
Shooting for the edit.
Yeah. Shooting for the edit.
It's a Hitchcock thing, man.
Yeah. Yeah. That's why people still use it, because it just keeps it works. It works, and it's the way you probably should be doing things. So,
So you see what you want already in your head 100%. As you're shooting.
Yes, 100%. Once he shows me the frame, I know what I kind of can guess, like, this will be, I'll use this for this part, and I'll cut back to it at this part.
Yeah. Mm.
So if I have someone say a line again, it's because I want to use that line again. Like, you know what I mean? Like,
right.
Like, little things like that.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
And a lot of that's attributed to, like, we work in documentary a lot where it's not like that.
Gotcha.
So,
but I think it helps that we both edit.
That's true. We both edit.
I mean, a lot of directors edit, but I don't think a lot of DPs do. I do most of our work. I do a lot of documentary shooting, but I do a lot of editing too. And I think understanding the edit and understanding the pace of a scene, mm-hmm. when I go to shoot it, I kind of know the beats that we need to be hitting a little mm-hmm. bit better. And I think when we translate that into, like, coverage, you know, in a practical sense, I know, like, okay, this is what we do need, this is what we don't need. And having Carl to bounce out those ideas off of, because he has the same kind of brain as a DP, director, editor, like, we both just know what we want to get. And we'll kind of, like, oh, if we have time to, like, be a little weird with it, we will, but most of the time we just know what we need. And, you know, it kind of takes away a little bit of that, I don't know, that stress of,
yeah, yeah,
like, guessing what the other person's thinking.
Got you.
Because we're both kind of thinking mostly the same thing.
Yeah, 100%.
We talked a lot about it ahead of time. So
yeah, we've had a couple meetings before the shoot.
Yeah,
but I think going forward, I mean, I don't see a reason, like, if we were going to do a feature, the amount of work that goes into that in pre-production and be months of pre-production, mm-hmm. Like, why we wouldn't storyboard it and get it, like, to the point where we're on set and we know exactly what we want.
Yeah, we're here, like, you come and you end up just getting what you get, what you need.
Yeah,
just plan it all out, just know what you need.
If you
to
do
get
it the right way, you have months of time to prep and see the locations or build locations, mm-hmm. and you know what cameras and lenses you're going to use, so, like, there's a lot less, like, what if, and it makes the on-set experience a little bit easier.
Yeah,
yeah. I don't think I've ever been so ahead of schedule like we were on this movie, though.
No.
Which I understand why that could be worrisome for a lot of people, because, like, you think, like,
you're just not used to it.
You should be like freaking out the whole time.
Exactly. It's usually like, dude, we got company needs to move, like, in like 2 seconds,
so,
dude. Like, you get one take.
Yeah, but I think 3 days for a 15-minute movie is, like, it's a good amount of time.
It's a good amount of time.
Totally. I've shot that amount of stuff in a day and a half. So same. I mean, like, I think giving ourselves, like, that runway to make things happen, like, we made it work. And I think that's, like, a good, like, I don't know. I think that's the way I want to work.
Yeah, it's a benchmark.
I don't want to be that guy that's freaking out and yelling at people. Like, that's, well, that's never good anyway. But but not that I do that. But like, I don't want to be in that position where we're so stressed out that, like, we're fucking running around like our heads are on fire. Yeah. You know, like I want to be cool and like be able to be like, okay, these are the shots we need. Oh, we have a little bit of time. Let's do it this way instead. Yeah, too. Like, let's just play with it a little bit.
We use it or we don't. Like, it's just one of those things. And like, I guess the thing is like, you know, it's a snowball effect. So let's say, you know, you're running low on time. You kind of, you know, as a director, you end up like losing the focus. Right. Like, you have to be focused on the story. You have to be focused on the script. The words are on the page.
Yeah.
And if you're sidetracked by meal penalty or just like, we got to get to the location, the sun's going down, like, why do we spend so much time on the scene? Yeah. You start thinking about all that shit. It gets, and then you end up just like losing focus, and you try and get shots that you don't really need. You try and make up for it in like weird ways.
Right.
And I've done that on a couple of the films that we've shot before. So I, you know, that's why I was so freaked out when we had all this extra time. I'm like, dude, something bad's about to happen, bro. I'm like, I don't know, man. It's like 1:30 p.m. We're not slated to shoot till like 4:30 when the sun goes down. I'm just like,
why? What is that? What is that about us? We talked about that on the way here. We have this like, we have this like neuroses essentially where like when anything good happens, you're just expecting something.
The worst thing.
Yeah.
Like, we're gonna forget something.
Just something good happened. Like, I'm gonna get fucking shafted sooner than later.
Wait, we actually have time to eat lunch, like sit down and eat lunch. Like, that's not good. Like, that's not a good thing, bro.
I can't eat lunch because something bad will happen.
Like, what's going on?
Paranoia, though. I mean, I guess it keeps you moving.
Right? Yeah.
It keeps you on your feet.
Yeah.
If you are ready for the bad thing to come, when it does come, you're like,
that's why everyone was so.
I was expecting
that. Is exactly.
That's how I feel.
A good chunk of being a director is exactly that. You have to be the one to think about if there's going to be a fire or like something that has to be put out. Like, you have to think about that stuff.
I think the higher level of the production, the higher caliber production it is, though, the less you have to worry. Because there's other someone else that's going to fucking worry about that. The AD or the production, whatever, you know, like production someone else on another level of production will be no, we got it.
You just worry about where
the actors should stand. Like, essentially, dude. When you're an indie director making a movie for, you know, essentially peanuts compared to big movies, you have to be worried about everything.
Because no one else is going to worry that much.
No one else is going to worry that much.
Yeah.
Especially when, you're not making Hollywood day rates. No one's going to give a shit.
Really, yeah, for sure.
I mean? So
I was thinking back about like Summer of You and like just give you context, like from this last shoot compared to like that shoot, the first minute, we're shooting outdoor, 105 degree summer heat. Straight, and Carl goes, I got 4 bikes. You guys get on. And we're going to shoot this thing. I'm going to
this cool bike scene that I really had in my cool head. Like, I had so many like visual references. I'm like, this is going to be the shot of the movie. It's going to be fucking sick. What happens after the first take?
I get on my bike and the tire just fucking blows out.
Loudest pop I've heard.
Where'd you get 4 bikes from?
You end up getting the bikes, right?
No.
I think everyone had a bike. Everyone who was like, Mike had a bike, Ryan had a bike. I think everyone used their own stuff, right?
I showed up without a bike and someone had a bike.
Wait, didn't one of you have a skateboard?
He had one in my trunk. Yeah, he had a board in his trunk. Yeah.
That's so funny.
If we didn't use that, I had a regular skateboard in my garage. And I was like, all right, we can probably.
But it was
like,
so funny. Like at that
This
point,
is where you cut in the clip of them all skateboarding in slow motion. Because that's how the movie goes. Yeah. They're all in slow-mo.
It was funny because like
we were just kids trying to make a story happen, and
we were adults at that point.
Make a story about 23.
I felt like a kid, dude. I felt like a kid.
No, you look like a kid.
Y'all look like children.
We all, no.
Mike,
like, Mike, beard. Dude, shout out Mike Palmasino, bro.
Shout out
Mike in LA. But dude,
baby face,
looked like a little baby, bro. It was hilarious. But I think what I loved most about shooting that thing was because like. I had no idea what I was doing.
Yeah.
Like, I legit just had a camera. I just got like that 5D or whatever, and I just hacked it to shoot RAW. And I'm just like, dude, I was so, like,
wasn't that fun?
I did so much stuff for that. Like, I would not do it again because I'm just like, that's pointless. Like, you know, like, but I had so much like care and so much like intention with every, I wanted to shoot on this format that I didn't even know. Like, I don't know, terabytes of data that could go to waste because I don't know what I'm doing, like converting the RAW to like an actual editable codec or whatever. I'm like, these, like, I was my first like foray into that whole thing. So doing that and, you know, writing the script and having you guys actually act it out and stuff, like, it was cool, man. It was cool. Like, it was fun, man. I feel like, a lot
of
those
things.
How
valuable do you think that was for you, like, now when you look back on it, trying all that crazy shit and like,
oh, and like failing a lot of things.
Yeah, man.
We shot in the rain. Like, it rained that one day. I had no idea it was gonna rain.
That's the best part of the movie.
I had no idea. The argument scene.
Really, it is though. No, really, it looks good.
Yeah, I was scared. I'm like, bro, I think it's weather scene. I think Cameron's weather scene. I'm like, Dave came with the mic. I'm like, shout out Dave. I'm like, just try and hide underneath the tree so the leaves cover it. You know, I'm just like doing weird things, dude. I don't know how this is gonna come out.
We've all been there, man.
Dude, yeah. It was great. Yeah. It was great, but like, yeah, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, dude, you could see that though when you watch the movie. Is it like the best thing you've made? No, absolutely
not. No, absolutely.
But you could tell, like, when you made it, you guys all cared about it.
It was fun. It was definitely fun.
And you could tell that it was actually a bunch of friends making it, and like, those are dope projects, and you'll always have that to like.
That's what I'm saying.
Look back on and reference and be like. Oh, this is how I did it when I had no money, no crew, nothing.
Nothing.
Now that I have all that stuff.
I think the total budget was like $300.
Yeah.
Like, it was nothing.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah. I think it was literally food and then like a couple props.
Yeah.
But everything else was all favors and just doing it ourselves and like stealing locations and like driving down the same road over and over with me hanging out of the trunk like with a camera, little shoulder rig, just like.
That's how it was.
Yeah. And that's fun, dude. That's just so fun. And anyone who's like starting out filming now, like, do something like that.
I was just gonna say, what's your advice, both of you, if you could go back, like, go to a William Patterson right now and like go into the film department and be like, hey, you know, guys, what should I do? I want to make a film. I think I want to be a filmmaker, director, writer. What do I do? What do I do?
Fucking go make it, man.
Yeah, go make it. It doesn't matter
if you don't have the money or the equipment or the crew. Like, I mean, get some friends. First off, make some friends. Yeah. That's step one.
Find people who like to do things.
Make some friends, even if they're like people that, you know, you aren't totally sure about, because they may prove themselves later on. Mm-hmm. You know, they may prove themselves to be great collaborators if you give them a chance. So go make some friends. Join the film club. Yes. Just because even if it sucks, you're going to meet people that want to make movies. Even if it's like the stuff coming out of it isn't that good. And then go make your movie, man. That's it.
Yeah.
Just go make it. Even if it looks like shit and it sounds like shit. Also, one thing that wasn't really around as much when we started was like fucking YouTube, man.
Yeah.
You can literally look up anything, any kind of cinematography thing you want to look up,
audio,
any audio recording.
You don't got to go to school anymore.
Yes.
Yeah, you guys.
In effect,
you go for the networking.
I learned way more online than I ever did in my film classes. Same. And I have good relationships with some of my film professors, and I think that they're really great people and they're knowledgeable. But like,
I gave you thousands of dollars to tell me what?
Yo, most of the classes were bullshit.
Paid thousands of dollars. I literally watched YouTube videos.
Yeah, you guys didn't have that really. Like in the beginning,
it was around, but like the quality of the videos wasn't quite where it is now. Yeah. Like, you can go on YouTube right now and get a full fucking cinematography course if you wanted to for free.
Yeah, exactly.
For fucking free. Yeah. Look up like Indie Riot and Film Riot. I'm sorry. Film Riot.
Indie Mogul.
I combined them. Yeah. They have so much stuff, behind the scenes stuff with cinematographers that are explaining things. You can Google the terms that they're talking about. That they talk about an RE Sun or an M9. M18 or something.
Those are things figure out,
or like give you just cheap equipment, high equipment, everything.
And like that stuff, like is invaluable. And like it's actual like practical knowledge that like you're serious about this stuff, and or even if it's just a passion right now, but you want to be serious about it. Like, there's so much knowledge out there. So let's just embrace the fact that there is knowledge all around.
And if you're in college now, let's say you are in the film program or whatever. This is like the best time, because when we went to school, we were kind of on that verge of the digital tape thing. So like, you know, you had your 5Ds, you had your Canon 7Ds, you know, you had
the cameras suck though.
Yeah, they do.
We're constantly working against the camera, against the shortcomings of the hardware.
Yeah, of course. And like, you know, codecs were just being rolled out. Like, you know, just like it was a new transition into Premiere wasn't as huge. Yeah. Like Adobe was not a huge thing. People were still, you know. But like
on Avid,
which they don't, you know, people still use. But I'm saying like a Premiere now is like huge.
Sucks.
You go to Avid, it sucks.
Sorry,
but no, I'm with you on that. But like, dude, even like the cameras these days, like if you can't get like a proper video camera, like let's say you are a super low budget, the kind of quality you can get with the money that I had when I was in school, dude, it would those, like, the cameras coming out now are cameras I wished.
Companies like Blackmagic, DaVinci. Well,
yeah, Blackmagic.
Blackmagic. Blackmagic is putting out these like $1,000 camera bodies that do 4K with like beautiful color. Just like color that rivals some $80,000 camera.
Dude, it's
like,
nuts.
And like, is it as good as the big cameras? No. But for a 23-year-old that wants to make a movie with his friend or her friend, it is perfect. It is the perfect thing that could be out there.
Such good accessibility now. And like renting the camera is like not expensive. If you have a bunch of people and you pool in some money, you can rent
$200 for the weekend
You know what I mean? You can get true like cinema quality, bro. But we didn't have that.
I was gonna say
we were on the verge of like turning into that.
I was really lucky. My last year of college, I worked at the school at the equipment checkout window, so I had almost unlimited access to equipment. Given it was a lot of like shitty equipment, but. I mean, I had access to like some film stuff. A Steadicam, an FS700, a bunch of film like sound equipment. So like the bar was much lower for me to get over to make these movies, and I made a lot more stuff my senior year. I could see how for people who didn't have that access, it'd be a little bit more difficult. But all the more reason, another tip, go work at your school. If there's a job opening at your school's equipment window, go work there.
That's huge.
Do that.
You'll meet everybody in the department, including professors. They'll get you on other jobs. You'll meet people who are passionate about making movies. You'll have access to all that equipment. And for school is better than ours and has good equipment. Or I guess Willie P has some cool stuff now.
I have no idea what they have now.
But if your school has good equipment, you have access to it.
Yeah.
And then when you graduate, if you can't find a job right away, go get a job at a fucking rental house. Go get a job at Able or Adorama. Go get a job at Adorama or Unique or somewhere that rents out these high-end camera systems. And then you will have access to professional equipment that you can use to make your films. At least either discounted rate or for free. And like that's something that you can't understate the value of that.
Yeah.
That's huge.
Which also leads me to my next point. The technology is so good now, you don't have an excuse. You got to write your story and then do it. See, me, you know, I shot on a 5D, and if anyone who has shot with a 5D Mark III knows that it had really shitty video, like it was really soft. And so I spent a lot of my time like, what lenses can like cover up that like softness? Like, how can I get the best,
you did all the research.
And I had to finesse a few things. Like, you don't have to do that anymore. A lot of these cameras come in with a log profile off the bat. Like, these little consumer cameras have log profiles now, like flat, that you can color easily and stuff. Just things have gotten so much better that there's no excuse. Like, you shouldn't spend all your time thinking about the gear like I did, because I was really into the gear back then.
Yeah.
You ask me now, I don't know what the fuck came out in the last year, dude. I don't pay attention to that stuff anymore. And I still shoot, you know what I mean? But like, I don't have to pay attention, because like everything that is out there is so good. You know what I mean? That like, there's no excuse. Make a good story, cast it, you know, appropriately. Get your friends.
Yeah.
Do the technique the right way.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Shoot it the right way, plan it out the right way, edit it the right way, and you're golden. Like, no one's gonna give a shit what you shot.
Number one, make some mistakes.
Please, yes, absolutely, 100%. And you're going to, don't worry. If you're afraid you're not going to, you will, 100%.
Yeah, because that's the way you like get better. With anything, man.
You're not
trying to learn how to bake a fucking cake. Make some bad cakes first.
You'll
know right away, this cake is not good. Maybe I should try something different next time. The same thing applies to making movies. Like, it's really not. It's not that hard to just be critical of yourself, and that's like
that's another thing. Yeah, just take that criticism and like, you know, critique yourself. You know what I mean?
Yes,
sir. Like, critique your peers.
Yes,
you know?
Yes.
It's more valuable, and it's not you being a dick. It's just you trying to make the best product possible, which is a goal that everyone on the team should have. So,
absolutely.
You know what I mean?
I'm thinking about like there is, when I hear both of you talk about filmmaking and like where you came from, it's immediately evident that like you gave yourself no excuse. You were like, I'm going to get a job at the window. I'm going to research as much as I fucking can. I'm going to watch YouTube videos. I got to do to make a film. I'm going to make bad eggs. I'm going to crack a lot of eggs. I'm going to make it happen though.
I'll be honest. I wasn't like that.
You weren't like this.
I'm before I started working at the school, I thought I didn't think I was better than anybody else, but I thought I was like, I don't know, man. I was an art boy. What can I say? I was like very, like, I wanted to work on things on my own. Mm-hmm. I didn't really like understand the whole like collaborating with people, even if you didn't really know them, like that whole part of it. After work, yeah, you're still,
that's
like,
me too,
you're still like that, Carl. After working with other people, at the being forced into those situations where I had to work with other people,
yeah,
my perspective on the whole thing changed, and like I realized the value in that. I wish I realized that sooner though. Mm. I wish I wasn't so into my own work, and like okay. I had this, I still do have this kind of like creative thing where like I'll create for me. If other people like it, that's cool.
Right, right.
But yeah. Most of the time I'm creating on my own, whether it's photography or art or music or, you know the same thing.
Exactly. You do
the same
stuff. You do it for yourself, and then if people like it, then it's a bonus.
But filmmaking is inherently a collaborative art, and you have to allow yourself to share the experience. Mm-hmm. You can't just assume you're going to be able to do each part of it on your own, which for a long time, that's what I thought I was going to do.
Same.
And that's not, same. That's not it, man. That's,
it's
not,
not,
you can't,
it's not
do
feasible.
That.
It's not feasible.
Giving up that control is
best thing I've ever done,
is
bro.
Like a huge fucking deal, man.
Yeah. It's the best thing I've ever done, bro.
Yeah. Yeah.
You remember me from summer review. I wrote it. I directed it. I shot it. Yeah. I edited it. I did all the audio mixing. I did everything. And it was such like a, such
I,
a thing.
I've had friends you know? Who are like, even now that like in, they're still in school or grad school, like be like, yeah, like I'm going to shoot indirect. And I'm like, I've done that a bunch of times. It almost never works out the way you're expecting it to work
out.
Things
will fall through the cracks.
Inevitably, you're going to focus your energy on one more than the other.
Yeah.
Get someone you trust. Mm-hmm. Share with them the kind of purpose of the story you're telling and how you want to tell it, and let them fucking be the eyes behind your vision. And like, it's just like ceding that control over everything is like, it's a test to your, you know, your ego and like your I don't know, your artistic, like,
yeah,
whatever, but it ends up, you almost always end up with a better product in the end because almost, you didn't just like try and juggle like everything on your own.
For the movie that we just did, I'll meet you there, like literally he was like, okay, what do you want it to look like? Here's a couple photos, there's a little mood board, you know, whatever. You figure out, I'm trusting you, the camera, lenses, whatever you need, I'll get you whatever. But like, I don't want to think about that because I've been thinking about that the last five projects that we did. Yes, and I realize it's kind of boggling. It's like I'm a computer and like all my RAM is going to that. And it's like giving him that freedom of just like, you know what I want. Like, you know what I'm trying to go for. Yeah. And I think you understand that.
Yeah.
How you get there, it's on you.
Yeah.
It's on you. That's your job. That's literally your job title. So you figure it out and you let me know.
But I feel like I came to you guys a lot too in the beginning and was saying like, I just feel like I'm feeling a bit overwhelmed. I want to make sure I could like give up. And you told me this. You're like, on the last podcast, you told me this. Yeah. Like, you got to give up the reins and like allow us to do our job. And like, I trust you guys, but
it's all trust.
There's just
baby.
A part of me that was like, I trust you, but like, I'll help too. And like, I'll ferry this one along with you. And like, you're like, no, just let
there's
your
some
hand
things,
go.
Yeah,
be,
yeah,
I got it.
It's
I got this. I'll catch the ball.
Yeah.
So it was cool to like experience that this time around, dude. I felt like I was in way less control, and I got to focus
too,
on
bro.
Just.
I was a director, and I'm like, I feel fine. I'm in less control than I've ever been in my life, and this is great.
But it frees you up for like magic to happen, you know? It frees you up to do your own thing.
It lets me focus on the things that I should be focused on.
And then that's true collaboration.
I think that's
true collaboration.
That's the threshold for breaking out of like the short indie film thing.
Yes.
Is when you can finally be like, oh, I have people at all these different stations in the process that are handling their shit.
And they're good
and
at what
I can
they do.
Just focus on what I'm supposed to do, like as this one role, as a director or as a DP or as an actor or as literally like any part of it. There's someone else who's stressing out about the small things that I don't like now I don't have to worry about that.
Yeah.
I'm like, that's invaluable.
Yeah.
Dude.
Yeah.
That's how you know you've kind of like started to get there. Cause like, When you're running on like you're doing a $1,000 short film, which sounds like a lot of money, but like that money evaporates so quickly,
so fast. Yeah.
So you have a script that you really like, and you want to make it with your friends, and you have $1,000 between all of you, and you go and you ask for some money from relatives, or like you save up your peanuts until you've got like, you know, you've got the money set aside for it, and you just make this passion project. That's because that's what it is. It's a passion project. When you're not paying people their rates. It's a passion project. Mm-hmm. You're asking for favors. Like, I don't know. Like, once you don't have to worry about all those things, or you have enough money that you can pay people their rates and like all that, like you're officially out of that like student film,
yeah,
indie shorts,
college,
like
frugal
college lifestyle, yeah, that just, yeah, those indie filmmaker roles, like, yeah. And when you get up to that point where there's like the stress is dispersed throughout the crew, yeah, evenly, and no one is especially stressed out about, yeah, the movie.
You're stressed out about what you should be stressed, yeah, out about, essentially. Yeah, 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 yeah.
Like, there's no one person bearing the full weight of the film on them. Like, it's a good experience. It, yeah, feels, yeah, good. Yeah. It feels good, good to, yeah, create without the pain, the painful part of it.
Yeah.
Mm. And then there's nothing better, there's nothing more satisfying than like watching it once it's cut.
Uh-huh.
And you see all that, man, work that you've done, and then you see what everyone else's contributions have been.
If it's good.
It feels, yeah, fucking great.
No, but, you know,
it's,
no,
why
I,
we
say,
do it, man.
I say if it's good.
Though. Oh, if it's good. Good.
If you go watch it back and it sucks, you're like, well.
Well, then that's on, well, that's on me.
Dude. But most of the time, when you've done it enough, it comes out how you're expecting, yeah, it to come out.
Yeah.
And you're happy. And
we've done enough of these, like, to know, like, you know, what we should expect, yeah, and like what we can do and what we, yeah, can't do, yeah, and like, yeah, just, yeah, knowing the limitations of things and being, yeah, able to stretch some of that if you can. It's really just like playing around, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
but like,
yeah,
after you've done a decent amount of them, you know,
five or six short films.
Yeah, like, five or six, like, yeah, you kind of like, okay, you know. And like most of the short films we've done have always been under like 25 minutes.
Oh, yeah.
I did one that was like close to half an hour. But like, other than that, like all that
everything
short
I've done has been 20. The longest one is 22 minutes, I think.
Yeah.
And then I'm in the boat where I'm like, short film should be short.
Yeah. 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 Yeah, for,
you,
sure,
know, I don't mind shooting or working on projects that are longer, but if I'm going to direct something, like, I feel like it's not worth making unless it's like 5 minutes long.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
And that's just my like frame of mind. I'm like, if it's going to be longer than that, I almost want to make it into a feature.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
So going forward, like, I haven't directed anything in since 2016.
Which the world, wow, has yet to see.
Other than like documentary stuff, but, yeah, but I mean like narrative stuff, I haven't directed in music videos. I haven't directed anything since 2016. So that one was my longest movie I ever made. It was like 22 minutes, I think, all together. And now I'm like, I don't want to do that again. I want to make, if I'm going to get everybody out, I want it to be like really short. Yeah. I want it to be one location, like, yeah, super short. And I want the whole film to be hinged on this, like the story,
yeah,
yes, the writing, yes, the dialogue. Yes. Like, I don't know. I'm not trying to fit a feature, like, feature
which
length
feature
movie
like
into
a,
yeah, a 25 minute movie. It just, yeah, doesn't work.
Yeah, yeah.
In some situations, yeah, there's some stories that need to be a little longer, but, you know, my personal taste is always like, let's just make it short. Let's,
yeah,
just, shorter is better.
Yeah.
Make the story like have less turns in it and just make it short and,
right,
and sweet.
Simple and, yeah,
it shows
get
a lot of craft, dude. When you can tell a
those
story
are just
that's
as hard.
That's why I don't make
like
that many movies, because, yeah, it's not easy to make.
It's difficult,
good,
man. It's truly difficult to tell,
yeah,
a full story in,
yeah,
a short
yeah,
format. But it does show craft. I think that's why, like, you start here. Aside from like the financial, like, fucking, I don't know. It's less money to make a short film. And easier to shoot because it's less days. You know, it's a training ground. It's like, how short can you make a film almost, where it's a succinct story, where it throughout you have good acting, good filmmaking.
Doesn't make sense.
But the what makes a short film really short, a short film good, is not any of that stuff necessarily. Mm. It's the writing,
yeah,
which doesn't cost anything.
Yeah, that's the best.
It doesn't cost
that's
shit.
The funny part.
That's the truth.
What it costs is time.
Yes.
Which is valuable, but it doesn't have any material.
No value.
Costs.
Yeah, there's no like,
yes,
yeah.
You can't go and buy time at the store, you know? So if you're willing to sacrifice that time and donate your time to the project and hone your craft and write a script that's worth making, a 5 minute script, a,
yeah,
five page,
yeah,
script that's worth making, that's a different thing.
Yeah,
totally.
Like you could have a terrible script but shoot it beautifully,
yeah,
and have the best actors
and
have the perfect like perfect sound design.
I've seen a lot
rich,
of those.
Yeah, beautiful.
Seen a
but
lot
the movie
of
has
those.
No fucking point.
Yeah, yeah.
And has the dialogue that's hollow and poorly written.
Ooh.
And you're like, what the fuck was the point of this?
Yes.
Why,
yes,
did I watch this?
Yes.
And you can see something that was shot on an iPhone and lit with a fucking flashlight, but it's written beautifully. and you're like, this was a good use of my time. I'm glad I watched this.
Yeah.
And honestly, like, that's a real thing. Like, it almost always comes down to story. And if the,
it is
like
the
all
thing.
The all the yeah. other, it is the thing.
Like, everything
the whole
falls
point
in line
of what we're doing
it.
Is to tell stories.
Yeah.
And if all the other stuff adds to that, that's great. But you can't save a bad script with good camera work. That's like, that's a no-brainer, man.
Yeah. Something that a lot of people don't really understand until they actually make their thing and they see it and they're like, God, this sucks. Like,
I think
it's one of those things people just don't think about until it's actually.
That's right.
Like, you write the script and you're like, this is great. Oh, this is great dialogue.
Hyperbolic, right?
Yeah, exactly.
You don't get anybody to
you're
check
insulated
you.
Totally. Like, this is my thing and it's going to be awesome. And
that's why I like criticism, man.
Yeah, dude, you need it.
There's not enough of that.
You need it.
I always send my stuff to you, or I show my fiance. I can't say girlfriend anymore.
Yes, congratulations.
Shout out Shireen.
Love you.
I show her my stuff and she's always like, it's really good. And I'm like, don't tell me it's really good. Tell me what's wrong with it. And I think she just doesn't want to like hurt my feelings. Like, no, please hurt my feelings. Yeah. Please keep me in check. Cause you're the only person who's going to be honest.
Yeah.
I'm going to show it to most people. They're not going to get it. First of all, they don't understand like how a script should be, but also like, they're too nice.
Right.
Yeah. I think like honest criticism is like one of the best things you can get.
Yeah. Huge.
Friend.
Yeah.
Especially
huge.
People you collaborate with.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think people are too scared to criticize other people. There's a way to do it.
There's definitely
not obviously. Shitty.
There's a right way.
But if you can criticize a work constructively, without
demeaning
someone, dude, that's huge.
Yeah. I remember. So we'll talk about this more in the behind the scenes. But I just wanted to pull some examples because it's such good, you know, what we're talking about here. I showed him the very first cut.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I came over one night, had a couple
of
beers.
What?
I'll meet you there. Like,
oh, got you.
Once you and I like kind of finished or whatever, I showed him the first cut. And he liked it. He was like, it was really good. Like, good.
Yeah.
But then we went back. We watched it a second time and we paused. And he was like, why don't you do this here? Why don't you cut here? Do you have another shot for this? What do you think about doing this? Like, it might be.
Yeah.
And I was like, where's my fucking notebook, man? Like, holy shit. Like, yes.
Yeah, you weren't fucking defensive and shut up.
And it wasn't like me going, this movie fucking sucks.
Right.
You
just saying, is this
you
the
suck
best?
As a director. I fucking hate you.
Yeah.
No, it was, hey, the pacing's a little off here.
Exactly.
Yeah. Why don't you stretch the time a little bit here?
Yeah. Right.
Like, this is our serious moment. It should last longer.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
stuff like that like, I knew because I shot it. I'm like, I know
and it's funny because, like,
I know you got a couple extra minutes of footage here. Like, just stretch it out.
Yeah.
And you know what? The next cut was beautiful.
Yeah.
So
you said the same thing when you came over.
I
even showed him, you came over before I even made an export. You were like, this seems a little weird, a little
something
jumpy.
About it.
Yeah, it was like a little, and it was too many cuts. And, you know, it was me just trying to find the audio, clips and just using those clips. Like I said, it was a first pass.
Yeah,
whatever.
Yeah.
But like, hearing you say it off the bat, I'm like, I know this scene needs work. And then when I showed him, I'm like,
same.
Yeah, the scene still needs work. Like, it's not good. You know, it's not up to par.
It's tricky. That's a tricky thing to navigate.
It's a tricky thing, man. When you're trying to do visual storytelling without saying any words, like, you need to stretch those shots out. Like, but you're also worried. And, you know, me, I'm like, the original cut came in at like 17 minutes. I'm like, that's way too fucking long, bro. It's way too long. We can't put this out.
Yeah.
And then. And that was without credits. Yeah, I'm just like, the credits is gonna be like another we're minute, fucked. Dude. Yeah. We're so fucked. Dude. It's gonna be like everything else we've done, you know? But like, the final cut now, I think the whole movie without the credits is like 13 something. Chopped 5 minutes, and I didn't do very much. You know, the base of the story is still there. Beautiful. We'll talk about this more in the behind the scenes.
Yeah. Stay tuned for
with
the
preview.
The round table.
Yeah. But, I reached out to you when I was in Florida, I remember, and I sent you the script. I don't know if you remember this, and you got back to me when I was in Florida, and we were talking about, because I wanted his.
Yeah, I remember you sent the script to him, and he was like, yeah, Dave sent me the script. I'm like, he sent you the script, and he didn't tell me?
Oh, shit, really?
These are my words, man.
I crossed the line. No, but
I think I already said yes, though. Like, I didn't even need the script, honestly.
That was the conversation, right?
That's essentially how it works. It's like, oh, we're making another movie. Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. That's awesome.
Well, it was funny. Sure. The very first inkling I gave, and we went to a brewery up in New York. Yeah. Shout out Industrial Arts.
Shout out.
Carl's got this fucking thing where he tries to be super mysterious. And he's like, yeah, there might be another project coming out.
Yeah, Jordan, like,
Carl, shut up.
We're drinking a couple pints.
Just
right?
Tell me, bro.
We're slamming back some pints. And he's straight up just like, so what are we working on next? What do you got going on? I'm like,
well, you know. Fucking like sheepish little. Like,
he's like, I'll tell Jordan next week. I'm gonna tell him. I'm like, just can I call
you
him?
You did. You were like, yo, when are you gonna tell Jordan? I'm like, it's not ready. I'm not ready to present to him the idea yet. Can you just give me some time?
Fucking presentation.
And Dave's just like, dude, we're like, can we just ask him? Like we've already had like three writing sessions.
As if like I'm gonna be like, let me get my guys to look at this and I'll get back to you.
Let me get my PR person.
My people gotta vet this script first. Like, come on, dude.
But that's a personal thing where I'm just like, I just want to be as clear and coherent because I don't want to be a jumbling mess when I tell him
Carl,
about the project.
You've been a jumbled mess since I met you.
Exactly. So that's when I realized, hey, it's not that bad.
I'm not going to say no anyway.
Yeah.
Like, look, man, like there are some people that get a yes no matter what. You guys are people that get a yes no matter what.
I appreciate that. That's on wax, dude. But that's where our dynamic, I think, is so fun. When I see it clear, when we're different, is like that, like a moment like that, where I'll be like, Carl, let's do this thing. And you're like, But I push too hard sometimes where I'm like,
we could just pick up the phone. Because he's definitely. Well, when's the teaser coming out, bro? When's the teaser coming out? I want to tell him I love him.
It's coming out.
I want to tell him I want to do it. Like, we just. But it's not colored yet, okay? The color correction hasn't come through yet.
But I like that it's like that with us. I do. Whereas Jordan's like a really cool head, and he's just like, guys, it's going to be...
Absolutely. Oh, on the surface.
Yeah, no, but I know. It's a nice balance.
Yeah, I'm the one who's very over the edge.
Oh, man. Oh, I could talk about it now because it's not happening. But I got... So, total side note. Sorry. Talking about being a cool-headed guy. I got asked to potentially go to Israel.
Oh, my God.
To shoot a weed documentary.
Oh.
And I was like, those things, like, what are the chances this thing would happen? And I was like, so stoked on it. I was like, a weed documentary in Israel. And I was like, I gotta take Carl. So I hit Carl up, and all I said was, you have a passport, right? And he's like, yeah, it's good till the end of the year. I was like, cool. I was like, I can't fucking say anything until I know for sure that we're going. I was like, I gotta tell Carl. I gotta fucking tell Carl about the weed documentary in Israel.
The first thing I responded was like, red light district in Amsterdam.
And I was like,
yeah, baby.
I was like, close. You're almost there. I was like,
what am I close with? The Amsterdam or the red light district part? Like,
neither.
But I was like, whatever. And then it ended up falling through. Unfortunately, that's the way things go. That's what I was talking about way before, about like, as soon as something good happens, you're expecting it to fall through.
Yeah.
And like when I got off, like I started being in talks to go do this thing, which was very nebulous. It wasn't definitely set in stone yet, but we had dates already. Mm. And like, this was like a thing. And I was like, oh shit, the end of March, like it's coming up. Like, mm-hmm. Fuck, we're going to go. And I was like, I got to take Carl. And I was already talking about with me. And then it falls through. I told Carl about it on the way here, so that's why he knows. Like, this isn't the first time he's here.
It's like an hour ago.
He's very disappointed. Like, he's very, very disappointed.
I'm still in my feelings.
Carl's a little hurt, but I mean, so am I. But on the surface, I was like, look, I might have a project. I gotta be like, it's no big deal.
It's all about containing expectations, like, right?
Weed documentary? Israel?
It's so hard not
travel
to travel like,
for work?
Yeah. Like,
you know,
5 days of just shooting on weed farms? Yes, please.
Yeah, but it's about metering your, I don't know.
Your expectations.
For yourself, too. You're like not getting too hyped on something that isn't solid yet.
How many projects, Dave, have you been offered that have been like just like hype train? This is it, and then it's like, oh man, we don't got the money for
that. I've learned to like keep my mouth shut to everybody.
That's what he was doing.
I'm trying to do that, man.
It's hard, dude, because you're excited, you're passionate about, or just fucking excited that your life is shifting into this new job that you're about to go experience, like going at fucking
it's so fucking random. First of all, I'm like, well, yeah, obviously, I'll fucking you know. And then I'm like, this isn't gonna happen. There's no way. And when it didn't happen, though,
you weren't as,
I wasn't like crushed by it. I was I fucking expected that. Like, money, you know, the funding wasn't totally there. Like, it wasn't totally sorted out yet. It's a very small project. Like, you know, it's traveling halfway across the world, but it's like, relatively speaking, a small project. I'm like, I'm not that hurt by it. Yeah. Not working out. Like, shit happens, you know.
Other things will come up.
if it was a couple of years ago, I'd probably be like, fuck.
Yeah. 100%.
I would have been so upset by it. I would have already told Carl. Carl would have been so hurt.
Like, I would have been crying.
It would have been weeks of him like packing his bags, getting his like his.
So we're not going anymore? Five trucks.
Cleaning his bong to put into the suitcase.
I don't have a bong. If anyone's watching this, potential employer for the future, I don't have a bong.
Yeah, well, you get my point.
Like we need like a docuseries of Carl going to places. Like Amsterdam,
weed show.
I would
go crazy,
dude. Are you kidding
Vice,
me?
Vice,
if
give Carl
has
a show.
Money out there, and if you're watching this, please, please.
Carl's worked in is it reality TV?
Technically,
we'll say yes.
I don't know.
Just say yes.
It's news. It's not really. It's not really reality.
So yeah, soft news.
Soft news.
Carl's worked in soft news.
Local,
give him a job smoking weed on Vice or something.
Yeah,
please.
I can do it.
If anybody from Vice watches this.
I would watch that, dude.
You guys shoot on the C300s. We shoot on the C300. You guys.
Not anymore, no.
Probably
shoot Sony,
I think. They probably do like FS9s or FS7s or whatever.
Really? Damn.
They did see
there's no money in
you see it. You saw it in the older.
No
money. Yeah. They don't have any money anymore. Spike Jones, what are you doing, bro? Get your investors up, bro.
Oh, man. Off the rails.
I need another beer.
Do you have any?
I'm going to go grab
there's,
one.
There's okay, three more.
Oh, no.
It's not open.
This is the point of that podcast where you start.
We're off the rails, ladies and gentlemen. How about this, dude? Okay.
I just want to throw in.
Go ahead, Mike.
I just want to throw in something.
Mikey's been silent.
Yeah, I've been loving listening to this. You guys are fun to listen to. But I just want to say thank you to you guys because it's the first time I worked with you guys.
Man.
We got to see Carl in action, Jordan.
Mikey's first time.
And I was really inspired and grateful that I'm able to work with people that have had experience and have worked. And I remember one of the things that you go. And like to see like a word on a paper that you put turn into like this whole 3-day you know experience, and for me to be a part of it, I'm just like, I don't know, it's crazy. And I remember one funny thing. My favorite moment from the weekend is after everyone left, and it was me and Carl, and we were drinking, we were waiting for Dave to, we were celebrating, obviously we're celebrating because we just finished waiting for Dave.
I was drunk
waiting for Dave. Dave fucking bails on us. And then we're like, no, fuck this, dude. We start drinking, dancing and shit, and we're just having a good time. And then we're...
Oh, no!
Ew, dude.
Sorry.
Terrible.
I don't know what soundboard you got there, dude.
That was... But I remember Carl... I remember we were looking through Carl's all his old films.
Oh.
Like Summer of
You. Yeah,
I
showed you all that.
Yeah, everything. And you never wanted to show me.
Yeah.
And seeing like all of those things.
Yeah.
And then I remember showing him stuff, and he was like, he saw West,
dude,
with you.
Dude, you have to see this thing that he did.
And he was like, dude, oh, you fucking get it.
You're
part
of it.
And like how you guys
were
talking about how you were like met in college and you saw each other like have that same kind of moment. I don't know. It just made me feel good.
I saw your movie, dude. And then I was like,
wait,
you did all this? Like you wrote it, you shot it, you edited it. I'm like, oh.
And that's the biggest thing where you guys were talking about like, letting the reins go.
Yeah.
It's like, I want to do everything.
I saw him giving you some looks.
Yeah. Because growing, like,
it's
this thing
trust,
that I,
man.
Yeah, this whole thing that I love doing is like, I always am like, I want my, like,
you want to create,
I want to create this for like me.
100%.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
and I think that I can only do that through me.
Right.
But through seeing this shit happen, I'm like, fuck, man. Like,
it's possible,
yeah,
man.
Yeah.
You can create with everyone.
Yeah.
You know, it's not just you.
I think that's why I was excited for you guys to meet.
Yeah,
Mike, and for Mike to work with you guys, because that he busts his ass like you guys did and like research like fucking crazy and buys the equipment. He does all that shit. So I knew there's a lot of similarities. He's going to learn from you guys being there. And I think it starts like storytelling is the most the best stories are the more specific and personal, the more universal they become. So they start through your own eyes saying, I want to tell this. What I see, I want it to get out because it means something to me. If I get it really, really personal and specific about the story I want to tell, and through my, if I could fucking make it all come together and tell it how I want to tell it,
right,
I'm going to express it. And then it's going to be out there for other people to connect to, hopefully. But like, I think it starts with that, but then it evolves into, it's a weird dynamic.
Finding other people who can.
Yeah.
But isn't that a weird thing? I don't know if I'm right or not, but this the thing I believe is storytelling at its best, at its core, starts with like the most specific and personal thing you can get on paper.
in a story format, like something happens with this character and he's going through this thing.
Act one, act two, act three.
Exactly. Yeah. But the more specific it becomes, then it becomes, only then, it becomes the more universal.
Yeah.
Other people will understand. There must be, something that they connect to because it's so specific.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I'll say one thing. Again, we will go into this further. But when we wrote the script, we spent, I think, almost an entire day writing things that weren't even in the movie. We were writing things about the characters and like we were fleshing out like where they came from and who, how they meet. You don't find that out in the movie, but it's important.
It won't come up.
Like,
but it does.
Yeah, it does. Exactly. And like when we were trying to decide like what these characters should be, you were pulling from your life and I was pulling from my life and we were all kind of just like doing that. But I think, you're right. Like it starts out with that very specific thing. And then when you bring more people on, they add their own perspective. That's the whole thing. Like, he had some notes when he first read the script, and he had
a lot
of notes.
You told me to get more specific on that call from Florida.
Yeah.
You said let's you got to work on the
dialogue. I said like, so the you know, one of the big plot points obviously is like revolving around the death of an important character in the movie, and like I just wanted to know more about how that felt for the people who are left Fuck. After the fact. And like
thank understanding God for that, dude.
But understanding what fear that caused for the person who was dying.
Yes, man.
And then what anguish it caused for the people who were left behind. And that's such an important thing that like, you know, I went through that. So maybe that has influenced my outlook on those kind of things. But I think like there are certain things like you're saying that are universal no matter where you are in the world. And it's like happiness and sadness and anger and those things that translate no matter what language you're speaking, literally. And you can write a movie about anything. And if you impart those things into your script, like, and you add some truth to it, and you condense it all and distill it down to what it really is, like, you end up with something that everybody's going to understand.
Yeah.
And I think that even if people watching this film haven't dealt with loss in the way that the characters are dealing with, they're going to understand what is being said. Because it's so clear. It's like in your face. It's like this is what they're dealing with. It's nuanced and it's layered and it's covered with like, you know, pretty visuals
and
acting
like
and like a little bit of like, you know, wordplay and stuff. But at the core of it, it's about loss and grief and remembering someone, that memory fading and changing and like all those kind of things. And I think everybody's going to fucking understand that.
Yeah.
But that applies to every project.
Yeah. Right, exactly. Yeah.
If you'd be writing a comedy and like, you could just be like, this is how people think things are funny. This is like a very visual way of laughing at something, or like joy can be translated, you know, without words, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that's like a huge deal that people need to like, you need to like, that's a part of the writing process and part of like growing as a person is understanding how to translate that.
For sure.
Even Carlotta, when I first met her, because you basically already had her attached. I didn't, you know, I never met her, but you were like, oh yeah, like I know who I want to play my counterpart, and I'm like, great, you know. And we had this meeting in the city. We got like a studio space, and we went over the script and stuff. And I was just, I remember being completely blown away because I, you know, she read the script, and you know, I'm like, okay, great, she read it, whatever. Like, you know, we'll just go over it, see what she had, like ideas she had. Yeah, she had like a binder. She had a binder and like she opened it and it was like back to back to back to back notes. Like she spent
questions.
She had so many questions, bro. And I'm just like, like, Dave, what do we think about that? So Dave, have we thought about that in the 12 hours every day that we've been writing this thing for the last year? Like, have we thought about that? But she came in with such like very pointed questions, very analysis of who she was like as a character. I was like,
she was already making choices. She was
I'm like, I'm like, she gets questions. It. I'm like, oh my God.
We've been very lucky with that, man.
Yeah. It's a great feeling when you get confronted like that. I'm just like,
man. It just gets more specific. That's all. It just becomes more specific. You have to answer those questions. You have to find the answers. And you imagine like, you know, my character is in a recovery program. I'll tell Carl. He's like, okay, like, well, why? We're not shooting anything about a recovery program. Yeah. Well, we are in this, but like, let's say we weren't. He's like, it doesn't fucking, or my friend, you know, my character is, you know, just tried heroin last week with his buddy.
Yeah.
It's like, we're not shooting a fucking him shooting right. up scene. It doesn't matter.
What we can talk about, like, yeah.
But it, it does
like you're matter. Writing about a real person.
Exactly. Right. Exactly. You
know? Real people have...
I don't, there's like a, there's a fucking German word for that. I don't know what the word is. It essentially is like revolves around everybody you meet having a complex and ever-changing storyline. And you interacting with them for brief moments in time.
Oh, I want that
at any
word.
Given point. I don't know what the word is.
Fuck.
It's a mystery.
Leave a comment below.
But essentially, there everybody you meet, everything you meet, every fucking blade of grass you meet has a storyline. And if you really think about it for any extended period of time, your fucking brain melts. Because like there is just so much happening in every life, everything around you in that like... So especially when you're writing a character, it's like you can write about these kind of condensed periods that you're seeing on screen, but they're if it's supposed to be a real person, they have a whole life worth of experience right, yeah. that you're not writing about. And you have to account for that when you're writing a character. Otherwise, what do you, you're just writing like a sock puppet.
That's right. That's right.
And what the fuck is
hollow.
The point?
That's yeah. right.
Very hollow.
That's yeah. right. Mm-hmm. Fuck yeah. Oh, I need that word, Jordan.
Yeah, we got
to
find that
I'll
word.
Google it. I don't know what to Google.
I need that word.
Doppelganger. Word for things that, yeah, I don't know.
Yeah.
But that, I'm glad that you were a part of this.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, man. Mike, it was yeah, cool having you on, man. It was so funny.
I hope like, it you killed out. It, dude.
Yeah.
I hope
yeah.
so.
Yeah. You got that fucking mixer the day of, like,
yeah. and you handled that.
Figured
like,
it out.
I hope I did. I don't know.
Handled it better than me, dude.
You ran the audio.
I hope so.
I love it. You know what I love, man? You didn't complain at all. Yeah. Which
that's the best
part. Look, there's always things to complain about.
I was using the strap wrong for like 3 days. And I'm like, oh, this is a lot easier.
Dude, man.
But it's all right.
Everybody, it was until the last scene.
Everybody like, on that set was so fucking
oh,
chill.
Oh, yes.
But like, everybody was there for the right reasons. You did a great fucking job.
Yeah, everything came out great on your end.
Thank you.
Yeah, the audio's awesome. Really good.
Yeah.
Oh, perfect.
The audio that you captured.
I was wait. I wanted to ask, but I'm like, I shouldn't.
Does it feel less like you're writing your own thing now? I'm gonna be on your ass a bit, I think.
Yeah, please do.
Okay. Because I really want you to tell your story. But... Does it feel less, a bit less impossible? Like, does it feel
oh,
more
sure.
tangible and like you
for
can
sure.
do this fucking thing?
Yo, Mike, if you sure. need a coffee boy on your
there you go. There you go. See?
Like a mean latte.
Bro. All right.
You yeah. want critiques? You want, like,
yeah.
this is part of the process.
Yeah, yeah.
The
for process. Sure. Latte, bro.
Yeah, he makes yeah. me
It's worth it, though. You saw it.
I think so, yeah, yeah. No, definitely, like, seeing, even with the Rose Garden and, like, meeting you and, like, learning about that and everything.
Yeah.
And then meeting you guys and... seeing what's possible.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know. I see the vision.
Yeah.
You know? And
yeah.
I want to grow towards that.
Yeah.
Movies are just one big magic trick, bro. It's got to be able to.
Well, no, it's true.
It's true. It's true. It's true. It's the truth.
Yeah.
I never heard that before.
Yeah. It's a magic trick.
I mean,
it's an hour and a half magic trick. A lot. It takes a lot of people
yeah,
to pull together.
So. Yeah.
Well, it's an illusion essentially too, yeah. though, because yeah, yeah. you're fooling people into watching this thing you made.
Yeah.
And essentially, make it the illusion of time passing, the illusion of light, the illusion of sound and,
right.
and personhood, like that these actors are real people. You want your audience to really just like believe that these are real people.
Right.
Yeah.
And if your actors are really good, the audience will come away thinking like, wow, I just watched a story about some real shit. Like yeah. these people are real. And you know, it's all fake though. It's all fake.
Yeah.
What was that one
it's all fake.
What was that one
but if you do it right, it's a beautiful,
it's beautiful
fake. So, I mean,
yeah, no,
that's
it's great.
The goal, man.
100%. That's what you want to do. When we submitted the Rose Garden to festivals, we went to the Northeast Film Festival
yeah, yeah.
and in Teaneck, New Jersey. And, I remember you saw one feature and you were like, bro, you like, I don't care what time during the weekend, like if you have to come back
you
and watch this
it.
Thing. And I'm like, all right, like, sure, I'll show up Sunday morning or whatever, whatever. And I went, I saw the movie. I was like almost crying in the theater, bro. It was fantastic. You know which one I'm talking about.
Yeah, yeah.
What was it called? It was called Saving Grace or something?
Something Grace. Finding
Grace.
Shot
in Pennsylvania. Very,
yeah.
Very small cast. Really, it was shot beautifully. Everything was so good about it. And then we actually met the actors and the director and
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah, very cool people.
At the after party or whatever.
Yeah, Daniel Roebuck. He was
Daniel Roebuck, yeah. And I met the actress. I'm like,
get him on the podcast, bro.
Yeah, maybe.
It's funny. It was funny because it's like I was like, she was sick in the movie, yeah. And you know, she had all this complications and stuff.
Shit.
Yeah. Yeah, it was tough. It was a rough movie.
It was rough.
But then I see her and we're having a couple drinks at the bar. I'm just like, oh, you're just like, she's like, oh, great, thank
gotcha.
You. Gotcha. Yeah, like, oh, gotcha. I'm just like, bro, like you killed me. Like you killed me on a Sunday morning. Like, yeah. How is that possible?
Yeah.
That's a trick, dude. And that's a trick. That's what you want to do to people.
Yeah.
With storytelling and any type of. Yeah, storytelling like that.
Yeah, man. And stuff.
It's like willing manipulation. Man.
But you can't.
The audience
that.
Goes it's, in and they want to be manipulated. Right. They want you to convince them that things are real or that.
Yeah, they want to be.
And I think if you can deliver that, man, you've succeeded.
Yeah,
you've totally succeeded as a filmmaker. And I mean, that's what I think what we all strive for is the believability. Is that you know people are going to watch our films and be part of the story, and just essentially be in it to the effect that they believe that it's real.
Yeah.
At least for a moment. Yeah. Like they lose themselves in the story. And I think that's really hard to achieve. And I think films that do that, they've succeeded.
Yeah.
Whether big or small films, it's just a thing that it's like capturing lightning in a bottle, man.
For sure. For sure. And there's magic to it. There really is magical quality about it.
Absolutely.
If you make the room for it, if you set the stage for it.
It's really easy to do it wrong.
Yes.
Exactly. So it's really easy to hit that mark, bro.
It's way easier to do it wrong than
But like whereas you're saying like it's a giant magic trick, but I think it makes total sense. From my side of the street, like walking into this one, where like the trick is, you know, you guys are setting up this trick. We're gonna make the lighting look like it's daytime, and we're gonna have this be the room that everything's getting packed in, and it looks like that, and it feels like that, and all that. Like I don't know what I'm trying to say, but I think I'm trying to say. If I try to pull one over,
you'll see it.
You'll see it. Yeah, yeah.
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 You'll see
it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's a weird dynamic. Like
you more than anybody else. I mean, like you're in front of the camera, man. Like if you're not genuine in what you're doing,
that's true, man.
Yeah.
You'll see it.
If he overexposes a shot, we can fix it. Maybe not as really. Good, but yeah, you could do something to it.
Yeah.
Your performances or whatever actors do,
that's what
you can't change that.
Yeah.
I think first and foremost, it's the writing, it's the script,
100%.
And then the people delivering those lines.
Yeah.
And then everything else is an afterthought almost. It just serves the rest of that.
It all falls underneath that.
The direction, the performance, and the writing are paramount. And like everything else that's happening on set is just servicing those core things in the film. And yeah, if you don't deliver 100%, like the rest of it can't fix that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can't fix that. And you'll see it. You'll see it in the final product.
Yeah. Oh, I feel you got to put yourself, for me, I had to put myself in a place where it was like, this could be happening right now. Like I'm not in a good place.
Yeah.
And like, I talked to you about it a lot when we had to push back dates, dude.
Oh yeah.
Okay, this I will say on the podcast now. He was not happy, ladies and gentlemen. Man. He was very, very. He didn't show it.
Shit happens, though.
Yeah, shit happens, dude.
I went over to Jordan's,
and thank God.
Yeah, him and Shireen were kind of crunching numbers, and they were kind of.
It made sense.
And he was like, "Listen, I know you wanted to shoot in October. I think we had like October 4th and 5th. Yeah. I think was like the dates.
Pushed it almost 2 months.
We pushed it almost 2 months, end of November.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I went over around mid September. It was like mid September, and then Shireen was basically, and she was basically, you know, balancing the numbers and everything. She was
That's our producer.
Yeah, she's our producer.
Shout out, Shireen.
/ production coordinator. She will be here for the behind the scenes.
Shout out, fiance.
Shout out, fiance. I don't know. But she was
we got to tell Dave.
She literally, she looked me in the eyes and was like, Carl, like we can't get all this done in like 2 weeks. It's just not feasible and it's not possible.
Yeah.
And as a director, I'm like, all right, I believe you. Like what you're saying to me makes sense.
It made sense.
I don't like that I'm hearing it. I know that.
Dave, you invested a lot of energy into your part and you were ready to go.
Preparation. Yeah.
You were ready to go early.
That beard, bro.
Yeah. Yeah. But I think pushing it back let all the other things happen the way
they need. Totally.
And it ended up better you know, well, despite
imagine if we did shoot it then.
No, I mean,
imagine if we did shoot it.
I think I remember the weekend we were supposed to shoot it. Yeah. It was like a torrential downpour something. Like we had bad weather.
It was a Columbus Day weekend we were supposed to do
And with the weekend we ended up shooting it was beautiful out. The whole weekend was mild and sunny and just like we had great light in the house.
Great light,
Like we just fucking lucked out. It's all like it's by all chance, but it worked out.
Yeah, yeah.
But and like it could have not.
Exactly. Foreseeing that. And that's what makes a good producer.
Is
being like a meteorologist. You got to foresee
the shit she did.
Fortune telling.
Essentially, you know,
with thousands of dollars.
Yeah, exactly. Stuff. It's not an easy job. People like to shit on producers all the time. And be like, oh, they're suits and they only control the money. It's the money's a huge thing. Yeah. And the coordination of actually shooting the whole thing.
Yeah.
We couldn't do it. Like, we just couldn't do it. So, and I remember calling you, Dave. It's the good stuff. And he was like, yo, what's up, man? What's up, man? I'm like, hey, dude. You didn't say those words verbatim. I'm saying it. What's up, man? And I'm like, yo, dude, I just met with Jordan Shireen and we were talking. And it's best if we push it back to like the end of November. Ooh. And at the earliest. That's like the earliest we can do. It might even be later than that. I don't know. Like maybe even after Christmas.
You heard him deflate like a balloon.
Which you just say, just like the helium. It's like,
oh, God.
And I remember you just being like, yeah, yeah, no, I get it. Cool. Yeah, yeah.
Tears rolling down my face.
I'm like, if you, I think I even said, if you want to trim the beard a bit, don't completely shoot. I was like, I know you've been growing
that's
that.
That's what he told me.
I know Lena hates it. I know Lena hates it.
I'm like, okay, Carl.
Yeah,
thanks,
you're like,
dude.
Yeah. You're like, I'm growing. I'm like, I know you've been prepping since like August. Like, fucking. But we need that extra month and a half, 2 months almost. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And but was, I knew deep down you'd understand.
Totally. Yeah.
I knew you wouldn't be happy with it, but I knew that you would get it.
Yeah. Like, you know, I'm not putting up a fight.
That's what we're talking about metering your expectations too. Like when I was really excited about that potential documentary thing I was gonna shoot, I was like, yeah, this would be amazing if it happened exactly the way I'm imagining it in my head right now.
Yeah.
But realistically, that's not the way shit goes. Yeah. And you know what? That's not the way it went.
Yeah.
Same with the movie. We all expected it to go a certain way. We were supposed to shoot it in the summer.
We were supposed to roll out the Indiegogo campaign March of 2019.
We didn't make the film until November 27th, 28th or something.
Yeah, November 24th and 25th, I think, or something
so
like that.
So if we had expected it to all happen early 2019, we would have been so let down. And so downtrodden by the whole process.
We would never want to work with each other again.
That we wouldn't have actually made the movie.
Yeah.
But if you meet your expectations and you go, I hope it works out this way, but if it doesn't, I'm going to fucking work through it and make it work. Then you can't be disappointed. You keep your expectations real low.
This goes back to your old question like an hour ago. I don't know how long I've been talking about. Like, what would advice you would give to, you know, student filmmakers? Be flexible.
Yeah.
Embrace the flexibility.
Yeah.
Understand that like what you think is going to happen in your head, it may not happen. And you have to be okay with that. And you have to be able to play around with that and
lose
move
your
things
ego.
Around. Yeah.
Oh. Don't like be willing to compromise.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because compromise. If you can't compromise, if you're not flexible,
yeah,
you're not going to make your fucking movie happen. That's it.
Yeah.
It would have been me in a cornfield by myself. Yeah. Dude.
You with a tripod.
Yeah, just like, all right, action.
Yo, I just prepped so hard for it, dude, and then that phone rang, and I was just like, this is crazy.
Well,
this is crazy, but I get it.
It was funny because October, those dates we set for October were already the pushback dates.
They were.
We were supposed to shoot this. We were supposed to do the Indiegogo.
Like July.
We were supposed to do Indiegogo like January of 2019. Yeah. We're like, let's roll in the new year. Let's do this Indiegogo right off the bat.
It took almost a whole year.
Yeah. We didn't start that till September of 2019.
That's right.
For better, though. For better.
Yeah.
Oh,
not for
so
worse.
Much.
For
and I was like, bro, we're going to shoot in the summer sun and it's going to be fucking great. Like the golden hour is going to be amazing. All this shit.
Oh, yeah. That light would have been nice.
And then Jordan, I remember when we pushed it back, Jordan was like, shit, the biggest thing I have to worry about now is snow. Like,
snowing. I was worried about that.
I'm like, we got this whole car scene and we want to do some exterior car shots and drone. I'm like, yo, we got to get the drone in.
And
bro.
The weekend we shot it, it had been like 40 degrees out, 50 degrees out that whole week. It was beautiful.
And I'm like, if this is setting itself up for just perfect failure right now. Yeah. Like, a blizzard's going to
happen. Yeah, we're going to get fucking
monsoon.
We're going to get fucking annihilated by a blizzard this weekend. And
but as a director, I was like, well, that's your problem. You figure out how to get what
you
I want.
You can fly the drone in a blizzard, right?
It's not a big deal. No problem. Not a big deal.
Sure, girl. Yeah, no problem.
Yeah. We have insurance, Shireen? No, we don't. Oh, okay. It's fine. It's fine. Either way, it's fine. But yeah, tailoring your expectations and embracing flexibility and what can go wrong. It's a huge thing.
Good point,
huge
Carl. Thing.
Yeah.
Boom. Good point. Damn. Well, that was
What are we at? What
I think we're out of time.
What time is it?
It's like an hour 40.
Whoa, over. Hour 40?
Yeah, we did.
I've had a pee for an hour.
Yeah, same, dude.
We drank too much beer.
I'm gonna ask you guys one more question before we go. This is an impulsive question.
Go
I don't know where it's going to go. What would you tell 10-year-old Carl and 10-year-old Jordan if they walked up to you right now? What would you tell them? Individually. Really.
Go to business school. Okay. Fucking moron.
No. Really.
Communication.
Really. I want a real answer. I want a real answer.
Jordan, you can go first. I got to think about this.
Calm the fuck down most of the time.
You know, good.
Like I said before, I had a lot of troubles as a teenager and as a young adult. And I wish I had the benefit of hindsight as a younger version of myself. I wish I could see the downside to the way I acted. And I think overall, not just like on a person-to-person basis, I think my outlook was just kind of shitty. Not necessarily when I was 10. I was pretty happy when I was 10 because I had a PlayStation and
I was gonna say 10 is a very specific age.
But the years immediately following that were rough. But I think now as a full-fledged grown-up, I think like, you know, is just be kind to yourself and be kind to those around you because life is extremely fucking temporary. Mm-hmm. It's the longest thing you'll ever do. Like living is literally the longest thing you'll ever do, but it's really short. Yeah. So just be happy. I'm not saying don't be sad ever, but try your best.
I wish I went first because that's the answer I was gonna say. Just be nice.
I like
people,
the answer
man.
You gave before though.
Yeah, it was all right. It's cool. It's fun. But no, same thing essentially. Just enjoy the time that you're spending. Like I remember when I was like 10 to 14, I was so bored and I used to complain all the fucking time, dude. God. I played this all campaign, like time. I played the video game like a million times. I'm so bored. I can't wait to grow up. I can't, yo, bro, enjoy.
Yeah.
Enjoy making that's mistakes. Thing. Enjoy the friendships that you have.
Guilt-free mistakes. Or
yeah, maybe. Exactly, dude. Like everything you worried about when you were 10 or 11, none of that matters now. The second you turn 18, like none of that shit matters. Like just enjoy it and treasure the friendships and the relationships that you make when you're younger. And if you feel like you are a creative person at that age and like you want to do it, man,
do it.
There is no
There's
reason
a very
not
low
to.
Threshold for failure. Like you just keep going. You create, just like man. You just create stuff.
Yeah, yeah, just create stuff. And a lot of it's gonna be shit, but you know what? It's your shit. And if it means something to you, then it's perfect for you.
If you do things often enough, it becomes your style. What is the style? Is like repetition.
Yeah, essentially, it's all repetition.
Like, you could be really bad at something, but if you do it for long enough, now it's like that's
cool.
Style.
Yeah.
That's
yeah. Style. Jump cuts. Yeah, that's fucking great, man.
You know, man, that's it.
Yeah. Jump cuts.
Montage.
Yeah, right. Like who's that French guy who did that director guy? Breathless. Godard. French. Jump cuts. He did like jump cuts.
Omelet du fromage.
Yeah.
Right?
But yeah, that's what I have to say about
God,
that.
Beautiful, man.
Beautiful answers.
Yeah.
Thanks.
So let's say one more time, Carl. Stay tuned for the roundtable.
Yes, stay tuned for the roundtable on the making of I'll Meet You There. It should be coming out in the near future. We're actually going to talk about it after we hit stop on this thing.
Okay, perfect.
Because we do have to talk logistics.
Rose Garden was seen by a director. I wanted to tell you guys after this. You're going to be hyped.
Oh, no.
Dude, no. Good things.
Oh,
good things.
No.
It's good things. It's good things.
I'm going to be embarrassed.
I can't believe it happened, but it happened. Sorry. Go ahead.
No. Go.
No, I'll tell you after this.
Okay.
I'll tell you who.
What?
We're tell you who after the show.
Oh, after
Mikey's,
the show.
Mikey's so
up.
Mad because we're going
bad,
so long over.
It's like an extra half hour. Yes. We'll be doing that real soon. We'll be doing that real soon. If you did contribute to the Indiegogo, thank you very much. when I laid out the credits. Yes, I'm like, I was surprised. I was surprised by how many people actually did it.
Yeah, friends and family.
Yeah.
Did that. And friends and strangers.
Yeah, and people who actually believe in this.
Especially the strangers who don't even know us.
Yeah. That's crazy. Thank you so much. Your money has been put to good use. We did not waste a single penny.
Not a dime. Yeah.
Everything had a reason.
Thanks, Shireen.
Yeah. Thank you, Shireen.
Thank you, Shireen.
You killed that budget.
Straight up. She murdered the budget, and she helped me keep my sanity. So, and that's invaluable. That's invaluable. Yeah, so, thank you again. That'll happen real soon. So, stay tuned.
And congratulations on your engagement.
Thank you.
Yes.
Congrats. I appreciate it.
Not you, Jordan. I'm talking to Shireen.
Oh, sure. Thanks, Shireen, for saying yes. It would have been a really awkward vacation if you said no. I'm not going to lie. Really expensive, awkward vacation.
And boom, that's the You Are Here podcast, episode 56.
56.
Realest podcast in the game. www.youarehearpodcast.co. We cannot afford the Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Anchor.fm. Boom, this is Mike. I'm signing out.
Hey, this is Dave, and I love y'all.
I don't know. I don't know.